jive and your hand is in the shot zone.
One, two, audio check, check, one, two, where's Sharon?
I'm getting on the board up top.
There he is, coming out.
Guys, is this usually where the camera's at? Can you zoom in?
Sure. That's not the camera.
And just as we are about to start this game here, we have about 8.5 minutes until kickoff. We would like to throw it again down one more time to our field reporter, Danielle Cardona. Danielle?
Here with head coach Mike Kelly, now coach, 700th win last week at Stevenson. Huge record. Only three other Division III teams have been able to achieve it. How does that feel for you and your team?
It's very satisfying to be a part of this, something that's gone on for over a century now. And when you look at all the different presidents, administrators, athletic directors, all the different coaches, it speaks to the strength of Widener University to have that type of sustainability. So we're very proud that we got to be the ones that got this landmark win.
And the Widener community is very excited when they saw that. Hopefully that energy carries into today. Now moving forward, you guys do have a 6-1 record, second in the conference overall. Playoffs are coming up. How do you plan to ensure that you make it into the playoffs?
Well, our guys have to play with a lot of energy today. A win today will ensure that we're at least in the Centennial Mac Bowl series. And then it means that next week playing for the Keystone Cup at Del Valle will be for the automatic bid to the NCAA playoffs. So if our guys don't have enough inner motivation just from those aspects alone, but that's why you come to Widener, to play games at the end of October and beginning of November that are meaningful rather than just being on some team that doesn't have these opportunities. And we constantly have these opportunities because we've got good people that play with energy.
Now it is senior day. Now these seniors, they've been playing with you for 4 years, your first year coaching. How does it feel knowing that this may be the last home game for your first recruited class?
Well, these guys will always be special to me. I mean, there's just, you know, they took a chance on a guy that, you know, they didn't know who I was, you know, where I was coming from. I wasn't even coaching. I was representing NFL players when I took this job. And you know, they showed enough faith in me and our coaching staff to come here. And you know, they've got a 30-11 record in their 4 years here, and they've been a special group.
Well, you've done a great job. We love having you here. Good luck today, Coach.
Thanks very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Honestly, I think they're our biggest.
Victoria Petty has done such a great job over the past 4 years.
and she will be singing today. So, Victoria, we will miss you and thank you.
Gentlemen, the captain will be nominating at midfield for the coin toss. The Widener, number 1, Montrell Hicks Taylor, number 10, Joe Fox, and number 22, Mike Razek.
And just like that, we are now, I believe, as long as our mics are hot, we are almost a minute and a half out, or a little under, from the start of the game. We're about to get the coin toss here to see what's what.
Captains today for your Widener Pride, number 1, wide receiver Montrell Hicks Taylor, number 10, the linebacker Joe Fox, and the kicker, number 22, Michael Razek.
Welcome. We're going to have a coin toss to decide how we start this football game. This is a head.
I'd be shocked if they didn't start a football game with a coin toss there, Matt.
I'm going to flip it and let it drop.
That's right.
I'm going to call it before I flip it. Where did it come from? Who's the call? It is a tail. Kings has won the toss. You have an option to even or defer. You're going to receive. What direction are you going to kick? Yeah, let's flip sides.
So I believe Widener has chosen to defer kicking into the wind here this first half, as in the second half they will be kicking with the wind, and Kings has decided to receive the ball at the start of this half. And we will get that high-powered Kings College offense coming up, these Monarchs here, and the power of Zach Whitehead and the dominance that we may see. And it'll be an interesting one, Matt.
Yeah, that's right, Nick. And you know what? It's a good test for the Widener defense to start this game.
But in the meantime, we will have the national anthem sung and presented by the ROTC.
We ask that you remain standing as we honor America and those who defend our freedom at home and abroad, as Widener University senior Victoria Penny will sing our national anthem.
Does that star
And just like that from Victoria Penny, welcome to the official game. And if you're tuning in to this broadcast on Facebook, feel free, or actually don't feel free, absolutely share this to your friends, your family, direct message someone with the link, because it will be quite an entertaining affair.
And real quick, just want to give out a shout out to Victoria Penny for that wonderful rendition of the national anthem. So, Nick, we're about to get ready here. Both teams talking it over real quick right before we head out there. Of course, Widener will kick to start this game.
And it'll be quite an entertaining affair. The anticipation is rising. The nerves are racking. The goosebumps are present.
That's right.
And we have quite an interesting event about to unfold before our very eyes as Widener's kicking unit takes the field, getting ready to start this game off right.
Kicking today is one of the captains for Widener. Marcus Miller, number two, set to receive for Kings.
I believe this is Ryan Gallagher, the listed wide receiver here with the initial boot, and we will see that one fly all the way downfield. Caught at about the 8-yard line, and here comes Kings running upfield. He finds a small hole, but he will be stopped just after the 26-yard line.
That was number 28, Elijah Walton, on the return. And as number 6, Tyree Nobles Jr. gets up, a little shaken up on that play. The powerhouse quarterback, number 18, Zach Whitehead, and the rest of this Kings College Monarchs offense set to take the field.
And this will be one of the more interesting games for us here, Matt, as we have yet to call a Kings College game here in our careers so far. So we've seen the brawls of Del Valle, and now we get to see Kings for the first time, and maybe we'll see something similar here. As Whitehead will snap the ball, he throws immediately, and it's almost intercepted by number 45, Aaron Mastriani. Very close there, just slips through his hands. And he will be regretting that. That will be in the back of his mind all game, Matt.
Yeah, I honestly feel like we, just like the Widener defense, didn't expect such a quick release there from Whitehead. Definitely tested the Widener defense, but almost to the surprise of many.
And now we have Whitehead again.
Interception.
Looking back, short dip and dunk to number 25. That will be Trey Campbell, who is listed as an H on the roster sheet, Matt. Can you kind of explain what an H is?
An H,
to the best of your abilities?
I believe it's listed as a half, not a halfback, because they do have halfbacks on this roster. I believe they just they set up on offense. They're either a running back or wide receiver. There's the throw from Whitehead there, way out of bounds.
One of the stranger listings I've seen on a roster chart so far in my career here at Widener, and a quick three and out for Kings College is what a shutdown drive by Widener's defense.
Yeah, that's right. Widener's defensive line, one of the best in the MAC. And when Zach Whitehead has the abilities that he has to scramble and run and pick up a lot of yardage, they got to watch out for him like they did on that drive. Great job to contain Whitehead and the rest of this Kings offense.
And we will see flags fly here as we will understand how the refs will deliberate this one. Oh, they're going to say false start on the offense as they will drop back some yards on this punt.
And that was Malcolm Johnson getting called on the offsides or a false start. A little undisciplined play there to start this game here.
If I'm not mistaken, we will see Mike Timonello on the punt here. Oh, I'm mistaken. I think it's Constantino. And another flag flown is number 81 for Widener will get chopped and dropped at the 45-yard line. And
Jared Reinhart.
Yet another flag here.
So we're just taking a second to decipher the call here from the officials.
In the kick, holding, receiving team, number 23.
That will be Davon Bess on the flag there for Widener. And while we have a short break before Widener's offense takes the field, how about these blue and gold jerseys with the lovely W on the helmets? What are we thinking?
They're nice. They're nice. I really like the shade of blue. Now, last time Woo TV broadcasted a game, we knew that Widener rocked the vintage throwback jerseys with the powder blue, kind of like an old San Diego Chargers look to them. But these are their regular go-to home jerseys, and they certainly stand out, and they look great. Wonderful job by Mike Kelly and the coaching staff to pick out certain jerseys to make their team stand out.
And if I'm not mistaken, the early PMC days, the Widener Pride and the Philadelphia Eagles kind of shared the same color scheme, that powder blue with that luminescent yellow. As we see the Widener Pride take the field here on offense, we have four wide receivers out, and there will be a stoppage and flags flown. They're going to call that a delay of game on Widener. And
that was also called on the quarterback, Sean McGackey. And Sean McGackey, we saw him just a little bit last year as he took over for Alex Krivda late in the season. Alex Krivda graduated but is now an assistant with the Widener football team. And look at this run. This is a dangerous run by Rob Ennis Jr.
And there we see one part of the dynamic duo in the backfield just making his presence known today. How nice is it for if you're Widener to have this tandem at running back? So young, too.
Yeah, no, very talented running scheme there for the Pride as we will watch this play unfold, and we'll get to that in a second.
McGackey with the short pass there as it is caught by number two, James Gillespie, for a short yardage gain. They will make the first down, and we will have a fresh set of downs.
To touch again on the running back duo for the Pride, Chris Randall, only a sophomore, and Rob Ennis Jr., a freshman. Last week when Widener defeated Stevenson in their historic 700th win game, Ennis Jr. ran for 117 yards and a touchdown on 23 carries, so they certainly fed him the ball a lot.
And on that play there, you saw yet another running play again.
That was also by Rob Ennis Jr.
And we will be hearing a lot from them today. Widener, over the last couple years, been more of a pass happy team, definitely more of a passing presence, but now with the development of both Randall and Ennis, we do have a more developed run game, and I think Widener's offense has been subsequently more balanced over the last few years also.
Yeah, it certainly has been more balanced. They do a lot of end arounds, they do a lot of halfback draws, they like to fake the defense a lot. There's a throw from McGackey. He was trying to find James Gillespie, but James Gillespie cannot handle that one.
Try to find that small bit of separation, and I believe while we have a small moment here, Daniel Cardona has an injury update for Tyree Nobles Jr., who was shaken up after the punt return.
Sam, can you let us know when we're back? Because Andrew's rolling a thing right now.
Great job last week kicking those field goals. Great job punting.
And thank you very much, Danielle. An update is Widener has unfortunately gone four and out, and they will face a deep punt here as Kings takes it about the 10-yard line. Interesting take as Widener immediately bringing him down. That'll be number 33, Mario Scotese. Or excuse me, Scotese.
We saw earlier Sean McGackie's incomplete pass to wide receiver James Gillespie. A fun fact about James Gillespie, his younger brother set to become the new point guard for Villanova basketball.
Oh, wow.
So lots of athletic talent in that family. And James has had quite the year with Widener this season. So we're looking forward to seeing more great things from James Gillespie as this season winds down.
And he is probably most likely going to be remembered for that incredible one-handed catch that he made. As we do have the Kings College Monarchs here ready to break down the first offensive play. It's a deep pitch, but he fumbles it in the backfield. He's going to fall on top of it, but it was almost completely blown drive there on the wide pitch by Zach Whitehead.
That is Gabe Bacella, who is listed as a quarterback. He does get some of the carries. We told you this is a run-based offense. Apparently, they are not on the same communication there. As that could have been deadly for Kings.
And they will fake the handoff there and try to get some of that yardage back. And it seems like they made up about one yard ahead of their line of scrimmage. So I believe a 7-yard gain here should be third and nine as Kings looking to extend their drive and Widener looking to hold it.
Yeah, that pass was caught by number 81, Tyler.
Senior Tyree Nobles Jr., number 6, appears to be out of the game after resetting his knee on the first play. Of course, Nobles is very upset about this. They will be monitoring his injury, and I will give you the updates. Reporting sideline, Danielle Cardona.
Fortunately, Widener was not able to make the big third down stop there.
A lot of dipping and dunking here by Kings College as they will fake a handoff. It'll be another play action pass, and he will get drilled. That'll be CJ Curry, I think, on the reception.
Huge.
He's listed as a linebacker on Kings. I'm not sure how accurate that is, though.
Yeah, we've had a few position.
Oh no! I'm sorry. He is on their second team offense, so he's listed as linebacker. But a reception by him there is, they will go back to the run on the second down and one.
On that previous play, it was a huge hit by number 31, Kyle Lowry, going by the nickname 31 Savage nowadays. That certainly was a savage hit.
And not the last one today either, as he was also a very key impact player for the Widener Pride against Lycoming on October the 14th. And we will see another drop back from Whitehead, who looks to be throwing sidearm. And he will make the reception as he gets chopped about 2 yards before the first down. And I believe that was number 17, Corey Flynn, for the Monarchs.
Yeah, another little slant route there by Corey Flynn. Kings likes to go to that. That's why Zach Whitehead has been so good, because little quick slant routes, he's been able to find his receiver.
And the Monarchs wasting no time here as they've seemingly been avoiding a huddle as they will pick up yet another first down and then some.
That was number 8, Titus Nelson, who was in the game. Just like Widener, they have a running back duo as well. Jordan Downs, number 38, and number 8, Titus Nelson. That pass from Whitehead was incomplete. I believe they were trying to find Corey Flynn again.
They have been working the short passes so far, not really needing to stretch out the field too much. They're respecting Widener's defense a great deal, I think, and I think they're playing it the smartest possible at the moment. And right now we have Whitehead in the backfield.
It has worked out for them, Nick. I mean, they've pushed up the field quite quickly on this drive.
It seems that they called an audible single safety. They will be faking a run and dropped in the backfield. That'll be number 81 for
Tyler Maroney.
For Kings. Tyler Maroney. And
second reception on the day already.
And I believe that was Jordan Powell on the tackle also. Now Kings facing a 3rd and 10 here on the 38-yard line. And 9.5 minutes left in this first quarter. Jeez. A little too late. I think I'm getting ahead of myself.
That's right. A matchup to watch, Jordan Powell and Tyler Maroney, number 5 and 81 respectively. As here comes Whitehead, the pass, looking for Maroney.
Oh, and they're going to call that out of bounds.
Yeah, the ref signaling out of bounds there.
Well, I mean, they had two refs there, so I think they might have had better eyes on it than we might have. But
it's a good thing we're not calling this game up here, Nick. But
yeah, I can barely tell that it's the first quarter. And, yeah, I don't think I'd fare too well as a referee out here.
That's right. Maroney tried to keep his feet in there, unfortunately. For Kings, out of bounds, 4th and 10.
And it looks like they're going to maintain the offensive unit here as they want to keep this drive alive. They want to force the score early and try to run it up here on Widener as we have Whitehead in the backfield with four receivers set up and a running back behind him. He drops back. I think he's looking deep here. Gets a little bit of pressure. He goes over the middle and nothing. It'll be a turnover on downs. Widener offense will take over.
Tyler Maroney being targeted for the 4th time. Already on that throw, just over his head there, and he had to be careful because Kyle Lowry was waiting to intercept that ball. So you cannot overthrow your receivers with a defense like Widener. So, I mean, Whitehead able to dodge a bullet there, but now Sean McGackie and the rest of this Widener Pride offense is taking the field for their 2nd time this afternoon.
And we will see how McGackie does on this drive. He will drop back. He's thinking pass. He scrambles a little bit, looking out of the pocket. He's running. He throws a short ball. He will connect, and it will pick up about 7 or 8 yards, and he will be dropped just before the 50-yard line. I believe that was DeAndre Sapp on the reception. What another great player that Widener has seen over this last recruitment class. DeAndre Sapp also been a very – very big name for this offense.
Yeah, Sappy Jr. from Queens, New York. Certainly made the most of that play. I didn't think that he'd pick up as many yards as he did. So great job by DeAndre here. Is McGackie going to hike this one?
Well, we'll be handing it off as he will break up the middle and small gain of yards. Nothing to write home about, but respectable.
Yeah, this drive, we're going to see Chris Randall, who was on that carry right there. Randall, 5'9", 195 from Lindenwood, New Jersey. So we do have a stoppage and I believe an injury, unfortunately.
Not looking.
And that is Chris Randall. So we will let the training staff tend to him and we'll be back in just a moment.
Thankfully, Randall able to walk off the field on his own strength along with a trainer by his side, and we will get an injury update from Danielle Cardona sometime soon as play will resume here in just a second. McGackie in the backfield with the running back behind him, 4 receiver setup. He will hike the ball, looks to his left. He fires deep, and he's going right over to Gillespie, who hits him, and it will be a Widener touchdown.
Wonderful, wonderful play there by Sean McGackie. Great throw to lead James Gillespie forward and hit him in stride. James Gillespie, wonderful job to outrun his man there. And just like that, the Pride now up 6. Looking to tack on another one here with Michael Razick out there to attempt the extra point.
And Gillespie, who just caught that touchdown, will be holding it for him.
Handful of versatile players for both teams today.
And what a good play. What a greatly viewed play by McGackie. Sees the coverage drop on that left side. Finds an open Gillespie in man coverage, who burns his own coverage. And finds himself in the end zone. And Widener, the 7-0 lead here with 7:53 left in the first quarter. And what an impressive drive there by Widener.
Oh, it was a great drive. You know, we saw it was a different player every play. James Gillespie ended it with that wonderful touchdown, but we saw Chris Randall get a run in there. We saw DeAndre Sapp make the most of a short little pass play to him. Wonderful job by the Pride to put themselves in a 7-0 lead here early in the first quarter, but one must think that certainly triggered Zach Whitehead, and I'm sure we're going to see a lot more offense from him in this drive.
Well, I was expecting to see more of a response, but I think Widener's defense has been so potent, and the defensive line has been causing so much chaos up front. I think Whitehead may be a little frantic there in the pocket, but we will see. We still have another three full quarters to play, and Widener will be giving it back to Kings here in just a second.
I believe this is Ryan Gallagher set to kick now for the Pride.
I believe he is the kickoff specialist here for the Pride, and he will launch one. It'll go beyond the 15-yard line, fall just at the 10, and he will receive it with no blockers. Oh, but he seems to be making it away as he runs his way to about the 34, 35-yard line.
That was number 28, Elijah Walton, once again. Almost tricked a few Widener players there as he faked a handoff to Marcus Miller. We saw a few Pride players be tricked by that. Who knows, that might have been the reason why Walton picked up a few extra yards there. But now Zach Whitehead and the King's College Monarchs set to come out for the third time this afternoon, looking to finally put some points up on the board.
You will find Whitehead here with a three receiver, one tight end setup with a running back right behind him. He will hike the ball. He does hand the ball off up the middle, and he will find himself some room as he will pick up a 10 or an 11-yard gain.
That was Jordan Downs, the more dangerous running back on this team of a few running backs.
Oh, and he will hike the ball. It will be yet another run, but the defensive line seeming to cause a lot of trouble, and he will trip up at the line of scrimmage.
Jordan Downs has more yardage on this team for Kings this season, 530 yards to be exact, as well as four rushing touchdowns, second on the team.
And as the clock continues to tick on, we're here with 7 minutes left in this first quarter. Yeah, similar setup to the last play, except Whitehead will drop back. He looks, he fires, hits a man, and he will break just about for a first down. That will be, yes, first down more Kings College. I believe that was number 38 for Kings, Jordan Downs, yet again. As we will see a four-receiver setup this time for Kings. Whitehead, he will hand it off to Downs. He will run right into his tackle and drop at about the 40, 39-ish yard line.
Yeah, we're going to see Jordan Downs a lot on this drive. We saw number 8, Titus Nelson, in the last drive, but now it's been all Jordan Downs so far.
And I think King's strategy here is to really grind down Widener with this run game because they've been pretty effective so far. As Whitehead will look back to pass, he will fire one deep. He sees an open man over the shoulder, but just a few yards ahead of him. It will be third down.
Marcus Miller being targeted on that play right there. I'm surprised it wasn't a Tyler Maroney. He's been quite the handful so far for Jordan Powell, but they decided to go with Marcus Miller that time. So third and 7 here on Widener's 40. We can see Jordan Downs behind Zach Whitehead.
And Whitehead will take the snap. He looks to his slot, and he will pass it to the man at the hash marks, and he will find himself at about the 32, 33-yard line. And first down here for King's College Monarchs.
That's Corey Flynn again being targeted. I believe he's the second most targeted player on this team today besides Tyler Maroney.
And the Kings have been going for more dip and dunk passes. They will find an actual 10-yard gain here as they find themselves inching nearer and nearer to the red zone. And they will find themselves just outside on the 20. So just in red zone territory.
Yeah, Nick, we've clearly seen they've tried a lot of short passing, and it's really helped them move up the field. They haven't done the long balls. Oh, Lord. Look out. Zach Whitehead fumbled the ball and then took a big hit there from number 50, Craig Johnson.
And if it was a combined sack, then it looks like there's half of one for Casey Kirshner also, who landed on top of Whitehead.
That's right. If you're a quarterback facing Widener, you better hold on to that ball from the snapper. You're going to get hit hard.
And that's almost two fumbles by this Kings College team as a deflected pass by their running back. Jordan Downs is They will find themselves a 3rd and 16. Now, I don't know. It's pretty nice out today. There's no rain. There's no climate or inclement weather here to really deteriorate the quality of the ball or play. And we've already seen two fumbles from Kings.
I think it's been more miscommunication than anything, Nick. You hit the nail on the head there. There's no weather affecting this game. There's a...
Ooh!
Oh, that ball was dropped. Almost a spectacular catch there. I believe that was number 25, the half, Trey Campbell. So it's going to be a 4th down now for the Monarchs.
And he really did reach for that ball. It was very impressive over the middle. Just barely got his fingertips on it. And as he hits the ground, he unfortunately loses it. Would have been very impressive and probably would have been the thing that at least give them a better field goal opportunity, as this will be quite the lengthy one here.
Mike Tominello, a senior from Belcamp, Maryland.
This will be a 44-yarder as it will just barely make it above the crossbar, and it will be a 7-3 game here with Widener in the lead with about 5 minutes left on the game clock here in the first quarter.
That looked like more like a line drive kick. There wasn't much air under that one, but to the surprise, I guess, of Kings, that ball was able to fall through. So 7-3, every team's goal on offense is to at least put points up on the board, and Kings not able to get a touchdown there, but at least putting some points on the board to put some pressure on the Pride, as the Pride up 4 here with 4:53 to go in the first quarter.
And you can't really be entirely dissatisfied with with getting at least some points, because that puts you within at least another score. Put up another field goal, you're only down one, and nothing to really be too angry at, as Widener looks to extend their lead here on this drive. We have DeAndre Sapp on the kick return to the farthest part of the end zone. We have Gillespie on the top of your screen. And I am the third guy here is a little tough to spot with the jersey, but I believe that is 81. I believe that might be Jared Reinhardt, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, mostly you probably are right. Reinhardt did receive a punt earlier, so I'm sure they would want him out there for a kickoff.
And here comes the kick by Kings. It will be a bit of a duck as it will land at the 25-yard line and just fall right out of bounds. And I'm very confused at what just happened, Matt.
You're not the only one, Nick. I'll tell you that. You're not the only one.
Interesting, because they set up on the left side of the hash marks. He kicks a duck. It's a bouncer, and it's a line drive right out of bounds.
Yeah.
I don't know. I have no words.
You're as baffled as I am. But nonetheless, Pride will get another shot at offense here. Sean McGackey and the rest of the Pride will be out there for, I believe, their third drive.
Mm-hmm.
If you're just joining us, folks, their second drive was a touchdown, long touchdown throw to James Gillespie, as McGackey will drop back now, faces a lot of pressure, still scrambling. McGackey just going to run out of bounds. There's a late hit towards the sideline by number 10, Bruce Damon. He's a player to watch today for Kings.
And a very smart play there by McGackey, aware of the situation around him, the pocket collapsing, and having that awareness to just run out of bounds, take a little bit of yardage with him, and just say, scrap this play, we're going to come back in the next one and try to make a difference. We will see that here. A 4-receiver setup, one man in the backfield. He will take the pass. He will hand it off, and a couple quick cuts as he will try to make his way around the offensive line of scrimmage. And I believe that was Ennis.
Again, Rob Ennis Jr. The thing is, and, you know, as a coach, you don't want to face this, but you have a great dynamic duo, and when one sustains an injury like Chris Randall, you know, it's good that you have another guy that you can rely on like Rob Ennis Jr., and we're going to see this here again, 3rd and 8.
Gacky, he's launching one over the middle, and it will fall in between DeAndre Sapp and the safety, I believe, number 29, Trevor Hill, who was attempting to ball hawk that play.
Yeah, I'm surprised he didn't, honestly. The throw was not one of the harder ones we've seen today. That was certainly capable of being picked off. Luckily for the Pride, that did not happen, as Michael Razick will come out to punt this one with a fourth and eight ball in their own 37.
Now, the last time we were here broadcasting against Lycoming, we did see a very slow start to Widener's offense, and they were able to get it going with some key pick sixes as well as some offensive possessions. And while Widener does have this one to their name so far in the first quarter, it's seemingly one of the slower starts we've seen from them.
Yeah, that's right. Well, that Kings is a good team. We're surprised. I think, at least I'm surprised, offensively, the Pride haven't done much. It's been a few three and outs for them, but I'll tell you what, it's certainly going to be heavily contested. I don't think this is going to be a walk in the park for either team today, so we'll see what Kings is able to do on their fourth drive.
All right, the next break in the action. And right now, Kings finds themselves on about the 22-yard line. As Whitehead will snap it, a quick throw, and it will fall just short of Marcus Miller on the bottom side of your screen.
It's a big hit there from Casey Kirshner. There is some laundry on the field. We're going to see what kind of call this is.
Roughing the passer, maybe?
The flag was thrown around that area of the hit.
And that will be roughing the passer there on Casey Kirshner, unfortunately. But that will move the chains up quite a bit as they will be finding themselves starting at the 37-yard line, or 38-yard line.
And I guess the ref thought it might have been a little late of a hit. Whitehead, there was a quick release there, but I guess Kirshner got to him right before then.
And, they will be stacking the top side as Whitehead looks to be throwing deep. He throws one up, and it will hit number 17, Zach Thatcher, on the back as very well played defensively and just stuck to his man and just kind of did what he had to do. It prevented the catch.
A position-wise, great play there by Thatcher. Decided not to move his body, letting the ball hit him, getting in the way of the ball and Marcus Miller. So a great job there by Thatcher.
He had eyes in the back of his head, man.
That's right. Looked effortless, honestly.
Yeah, really.
It's going to be second
and 10. It's almost like he didn't know what was happening.
Yeah.
And we will see Whitehead again here for Kings, as I believe the receivers jumped a little early, but ooh. Big hit by 31 Savage, Kyle Lowry.
Lowry wanted to make sure if this guy got the ball that he was going to get taken to the ground. That was number 25, Trey Campbell, being targeted yet again. Great pressure from Kyle Lowry.
And we see a defensive substitution at line. We have number 90, Jalen Singleton, coming in for number 72, Mike Mataluna. As Whitehead will take the snap, he looks to drop back, pressure collapsing on the pocket, and he will get intercepted by Jordan Powell, but we will have a flag at around the 36-yard line, and we will see what the referees have to say about this as they deliberate here. Impressive read, and it will be an ineligible receiver downfield call here on Kings, and Widener with no opposition, no call to take it back. It will be their ball and an interception from Jordan Powell.
Yet another one for Jordan Powell. That's going to be his fifth on the season. Great awareness, great job by Powell to put himself in that position to catch the ball and tack on his fifth interception this year.
And Widener will take over with a three-receiver setup down at the bottom of your screen, one up top. He will be handing it off as he will get plenty of room to run all the way up until the 50-yard line.
It's full speed ahead there for Rob Ennis Jr.
It looked like he was about to try to take off. If he got a little bit of space, I think it would have been a clean first down.
Chris Randall is on the sideline here with ice after an ankle injury. No word on the seriousness of it or if he will return into the game. Now, also, it is confirmed that senior Tyree Nobles Jr. will be out for the remainder of the game. We were unable to get an official report on his exact injury. However, he did come out of the locker room with a brace on his knee. He is understandably very upset as this was his last home game of the regular season. His family, friends, and teammates are very emotional as well as he was such a strong contributor to the team. Reporting sideline, Danielle Cardona.
Wonderful attempt there, but could not bring that one down.
And McGackie will take the snap. He's looking to the bottom side. It will be Montrell Hicks-Taylor who is there for the reception, and he is in for the touchdown, 13-3 Widener.
That was a wonderful throw there by Sean McGackie. Once again, hitting his receiver in stride. He floated one up and over there for Montrell Hicks-Taylor. And now we're going to see the point after attempt here by Michael Razick.
And what a reception that was. A bit of blown coverage from Kings as Montrell Hicks-Taylor just blows by his receiver. Makes a big bit of a recovery, avoiding the stumble with the post-catch run. And we see some flags fly here before the PAT.
Nick, we mentioned earlier we thought Montrell Hicks-Taylor would have a big game today. Wonderful job there, as there was a false start on number 62, Jake Keim.
And just in case you thought this PAT couldn't get any more exciting, they will back it up 5 whole yards from the 30. Or excuse me, from the 10 or 5, either way. It's up and good. It'll be 14-3 Widener. And leave you have a thing, Matt?
Yeah, I do. 14-3, another wonderful job there by the Widener offense, but we are going to send it down to Danielle Cardona, who has an injury update for us. Over to you, Danielle.
Marcus Miller and a level Walton beat. Ryan Gallagher to kick off.
And look at this return here by number 2, Marcus Miller. There's going to be a flag thrown.
Oh, there was 2 flags there in 2 different spots. As we appreciate Danielle for that update again. Randall is currently out just getting ice for his ankle, and also Tyree Nobles is out for the game.
Illegal block in the back. Return team number 12. Half the distance to the goal. First down.
So that will be Tommy, I'm not so happy about that Gilmore, as unfortunately takes the flag for Kings. We'll be forced back a little bit on the kickoff, and I believe they will find themselves at about the, oh, wow, looking to be about the 7.5-ish yard line.
Yeah. And I don't know if the camera is panning over to them, but the ROTC here at Widener University has a tradition of doing as many push-ups as points that Widener has, and I guess drop and give me 14.
Oh, they're going right now. And as Widener shows blitz a little bit, Whitehead will be throwing short on the outside to his favorite target.
Yep, Tyler Maroney once again. Good hit by Jordan Powell from behind to make sure he doesn't get it that many more yards. As it's going to be 2nd down and 2.
Yet another quick play call, by the way. As he will be handing it off. It'll be a quick run, trying to force that first down on the ground, and he will not be getting too much farther.
Looks like Titus Nelson now. Jordan Downs was the running back for the last drive, so now it's Titus Nelson.
You know, you get a turn, I get a turn type of deal.
Yep, that's right. Like I said, I feel like a lot of teams in this MAC have a two running back set. However, for Widener, their two running back set was just very, very talented.
Kind of really disgusting, actually. As Whitehead will be dropping back, he gets surrounded, and I think he fumbled the ball. And I believe it got dropped at about the 10-yard line. Oh, no, they will be. They called it a dead ball sack.
Listen, Zach Whitehead, you can be as good as you can, but when Widener has the talent that they do with that defensive line, with the linebackers, with the defensive backs, you're going to struggle, unfortunately. And
they certainly have been, to be honest.
Yeah, Whitehead has taken his fair share of hits already here in this first quarter. He's going to drop back now. He's going to find number 25, Trey Campbell.
And he gets
brought down by the 20.
He gets absolutely gang-tackled by three Widener players. He is a large individual.
Yeah, it takes a while for him to go down, and that would have been a great gain on any other play if it wasn't second and 19, but it's going to be third and 7 now as Whitehead will look to snap this ball. Whitehead will drop back, plays into the middle there. They're saying that ball was caught. That was caught by number 81, Tyler Maroney. I thought that ball hit the ground. Apparently not. It's a good thing, once again, that I'm not wearing the striped shirt on the field.
But
first down.
Interestingly enough, we will see ourselves a fresh set of downs as he will throw to the outside. And, oh, a bit of helmet-on-helmet contact by the wider players there.
Yeah. Anthony Liberato Scully and I believe Brian Armstrong were there.
And with that, that will be the first quarter in the books. Widener finding themselves on top with an 11-point lead here against the King's College Monarchs. And just like that, with a quarter in the books, we are seeing the switching of sides here as Whitehead will be operating from left to right now on your screen. And we have some stats we will be looking at here when we get the opportunity. Whitehead under center right now backs up. Slight audible here for Kings. 5 seconds left on the play clock. He hikes the ball. It will be a handoff. And oh, number 8, Titus Nelson, tries to truck over a Widener player, and Joe Fox bringing him down. So in the first quarter, Kings had one more passing yard than Widener is. Whoa, he will drop it. Cannot stomach that type of attempt as Tyler Maroney pulling a Nelson Aguilar circa 2016 as he drops that ball. It was in the breadbasket. All he has to do is reach out, pull in. That's a touchdown, Matt.
That's right. It's unfortunate drop there by Maroney. That was a long play there, and Tyler Maroney not able to capitalize, and it's going to be second down now instead of a touchdown. So.
Yeah, that
bad break there for Mr. Maroney.
Shooting himself in the foot a little bit as Kings will attempt to come back. We see another short pass and another drop. This time on the hit by, I believe, that's Joe Fox.
Joe Fox, you got to put a lot of power into that one because that was Trey Campbell once again being targeted. And it's going to be 3rd and 10 now.
Got to imagine if there was D3 fantasy football, Tyler Maroney might have gotten angrily dropped in that instance.
Yeah, oh, most certainly, Nick.
A lot of angry potential fantasy owners in that. And we will have Whitehead dropping back. It will be a screen he will hurdle a guy and not go down just yet, but he seems to be forward progress at about the 48-yard line.
That was Titus Nelson, 5'11", 236, a big boy out there. And Widener was luckily able to take him to the ground and not let that third down conversion happen. So it's going to be 4th and 3 as Mike Tominello will step out for another punt. In a 14-3 game, you best believe that Kings was not happy about that, but they're going to have to do it again.
Oh, ran with it a little bit as it will drop, and he will run with it. Breaks a tackle and breaks a couple more, and he will find himself at about the 26-yard line. What an impressive run off of a really awkward bounce.
Tim Costantino.
I don't know why we have the kicker and punter on the roster chart listed, but it's number 14, Tim Costantino, on the kicks there.
Yeah, that's. I thought he was running with it for a second. Looked like your nice typical rugby punt there is. Widener will now take over on downs.
McGackey will be handing it off to Ennis, who will be breaking around the outside. He catches a block and will help push number 2, James Gillespie, seemingly out of bounds, as find themselves a fresh set of downs on that run.
That was a quick little handoff too, Nick. I don't know if you noticed that or not. It didn't look like your typical handoff there. Just a quick handing of the ball. Chris Randall, nice first down there.
And just like that, we will see another one from McGackey. He will be looking to pass here. He scrambles out of the pocket. He sees an option, and it will be almost intercepted. What a good read by defensive back Cody Stevens on that swat.
That was very dangerous. It looked like Stevens knew exactly where that ball was going to be.
Yeah, they read the route. It looked like jumped it a little early. Not really much opportunity for the receiver to come up for that ball, and almost an interception for Kings. And Widener will have another chance here. It is only 2nd down.
I feel like that's happened earlier in the first quarter as well for McGackey, just avoiding the interception. So 2nd and 10, ball on the 36 here for your Widener Pride offense. Rob Ennis Jr., the running back in the backfield, and he's going to receive that ball.
Yes.
Pick up a few yards there.
If he's lucky.
Make this 3rd down just a tiny bit easier. And Mike Doan was there on the stop.
You know, actually, fun fact. I was looking at the Kings College sports roster yesterday. On their hockey team, there is a goalie named Jake Tugnutt, son of famous NHL goalie Ron Tugnutt. It looks like he will be.
I think Ennis caught that ball.
That was very impressive. I couldn't tell myself, but it's quite the play. Interestingly enough, and unfortunately, Tugnutt does not play for the football team here, but I figured that was a nice little fun fact. Former NHLer, played for the Pittsburgh Penguins. I believe also played for the Dallas Stars.
Always got to talk.
Bit of a name.
Yeah, always got to talk about the connections that some of these players have, as mentioned earlier, with Gillespie and his younger brother. And, of course, for Kings.
And we will see a punt here. It'll be a deep one as it will drop to about the 27-yard line, and it will get brought down not too far after, about the 34.
Just a few yards on that return for Marcus Miller. We've spoken about him quite a few times today. And we're going to have the Kings College Monarchs come back out here. Zach Whitehead trying to get his players together. Whitehead, a 6'2", 270 senior from Hokesson, Delaware. This team fairly local, aside from a John Rauch, a left tackle from Connecticut. But it's not too far away from here, as Whitehead, with Downs behind him, will take the snap.
Drop back, and he does seem to fire over the middle. He will almost pick up a first down, if not get it. As Widener finds himself, it's about 11 and a half minutes left in this second quarter. The clock ticks on, and we have a fresh set of downs here for the King's College Monarchs. And Whitehead will snap it and throw it out wide. And Kirshner almost absolutely got up there for the SWAT. He just tried to just reach over top of him and just barely missed his arm.
That was Tyler Maroney on the 3-yard reception there.
And they are stacked at the wide receiver right now. Danny behind Whitehead. Whitehead looking back, fakes a throw, and he will just dip it off to Maroney yet again. And unfortunately for them, no yards. And they will find themselves in a third down and 7 situation with 11 minutes here left to go.
And Nick, I'm not comparing him to this man either, but this pass from Zach Whitehead looked like a little Aaron Rodgers, just a little flip. Unfortunately, that did not connect with Tyler Maroney there, but he had the same motive as I'm sure Aaron Rodgers does when he does those little short tosses.
Well, I hope your comparison to Aaron Rodgers isn't as true to life, as he did break his collarbone not too long ago, and he will almost throw an interception there. And flags will get thrown in the backfield, too. We'll see. Interesting to see what the refs call here.
I believe Murray Wells Dotson almost got that interception.
It was apparently a flag on the defense as the mic cuts out. I understand production is tough, and sometimes technology always doesn't agree with you, but we'll press on as the offense will get yet another opportunity.
That's right, Nick. I was going to say, we understand it more than I'm sure a lot of viewers do at home, how tough connection could be with microphones and whatnot. And so we eventually we'll find out what that penalty was, but it's going to be a first and 10.
For now, it was just defense. All the only call we got was defense. And now we will see Whitehead here drop back, pressure on, and he will find his favorite target, Maroney. He spins off a tackle and just short of the 30-yard line. And what an impressive play there by the King's College Monarchs.
Again, they're sticking to their bread and butter, and that is the short passes. The short passes let them move up the field. And Widener, sadly, has not been the best with them. Is Whitehead going to scrape a little bit and get taken down there? Number 12, Casey Kirshner, yet again with a sack. Great job by Casey there.
Definitely a big-time player making big-time plays as we continue on here throughout the game. We have about 10 minutes left here in the first half. It's Whitehead, the single man in the backfield. Widener with two safeties out there. Will be sacked. Vincent Char in the backfield. What a play by the Widener Pride here on third down now. Monarchs looking to fairly pressured here by this defensive line.
If there's a big hit in the backfield, you can assume if it's not Kirshner, it's Vince Char. If it's not Vince Char, then it's Kirshner. These two have worked great together side by side this season, and it's going to be a third and 20.
Yeah, quite the margin of distance here for these Monarchs.
Seems like a third and forever here.
More or less, as Whitehead will take the snap. He looks deep. He picks up the pressure in front of him, and there's people running all over. Sends it deep, but it's going to be intercepted by Jordan Powell, and he will be dropped at about the 5-yard line. What another play.
Jordan Powell, interception number 2 on the day. And you know, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, having Italian class with this young man, I don't expect to see him come out here and get essentially almost an interception per game now. But
is mucho bene very good? Mucho bene?
Si.
I'm Italian and I don't even know myself. Is that a disgrace? I'm not sure.
You can tell my Italian skills are not quite up to par yet. That's why I'm taking the class. But Jordan Powell.
God bless you.
Yes. Jordan Powell, hats off to him with his second interception on the day.
And now Widener in a bit of a tough spot as the ball is on the 5-yard line. They will be trying to get out of this one as McGackie will be throwing, and he finds Montrell Hicks Taylor, who's cutting across the middle of the field and gets brought down to about the 14-yard line. And there we go. That's Widener getting out of that tough spot, getting out of the end zone. And I think now we can see a proper drive here from Widener.
Yeah, you know, a quick little slant play there. Wonderful job to find Montrell. And with Montrell's speed and versatility, it takes a little longer for him to go down. A lot longer from others. So,
yes.
Great job by Montrell to gain 7 yards on a tough spot.
And now we have McGackie again with a short pass, and it's going to be number 83 who fumbles. Oh, 83. That will be Pat Downey who makes the reception and fumbles it. That is unfortunate here for the Widener Pride. A terrible position. He's just made an important stop. Jordan Powell picks up the ball, and then you immediately give it right back to the team.
Yeah, big takeaway there.
Hate to see
Kings
it happen.
College. Yeah, we're not the happiest on that play, but Kings will now come out here in very good field position to start this dangerous drive in a 14-3 game. Starting off in this field position, you would think that Kings could put some damage here on the scoreboard.
I hate to see the kid go out like that. Is Whitehead, I believe, will be coming back out onto the field here. It hasn't made the biggest impact yet. They still only have 3 points here in this first half. Usually a very dynamic offense, and not much yet from Whitehead as we get a flag and deep in the Widener backfield. Oh, never mind. It's a delay of game on Whitehead. Can't imagine the Kings coaches next to us are very happy about that.
I don't even think Whitehead's happy about it, as he shouldn't be. And that's just undisciplined. You get a wonderful field position like this, and you're going to get called for a delay game. Bad miscommunication there by Kings, and poor play there.
And now we have
penalty.
Now we have them backed up to their own 35, as he will be airing this one out, and it looks like it's just going to drop. And smart play by the Widener defensive backs, avoiding as much contact as possible, just staying with his man. It was a good play.
Yeah, I believe that was Nyree Wells Dotson on the play there, the number 20 for them. Second and 15 with the delay game penalty still intact.
Man in motion is Whitehead will take the snap. He hands it off, and he will fall very short of the original line of scrimmage, only getting to about the 33-yard line here as clock continues to tick down. It's 3rd and 15.
Third and 15. You know, you don't want this if you're Kings. Again, just
they're almost out of field goal range. I mean,
in Division III, one might think so, but you know, that was just a costly penalty, unnecessary penalty.
Whitehead again with the drop back here. He sees pressure, but he gets pulled down from behind, and there's a flag.
Widener might want to be careful here. We've seen a roughing the passer call earlier on a questionable call, so who knows what will happen here. Vince Char was all over Whitehead on that play.
And here comes a call from the stripes down on the field. And now we did not get much of a number there, as it absolutely cut out early, and that was a very bad penalty to take.
Yeah, all we heard was number 20. We don't believe Nyree Wells Dotson was involved in that play, but that is a costly penalty for Widener. Just like Kings had one, Widener had one earlier, and the players having to point out that there was still a flag on the field.
You know, when you're the stripes, you really got to stress in your training. You got to clean up the field. You got to clean up the messes out there, especially
right.
The ones you make.
That's right.
I feel like that's something you learn as a kid.
Oh, yeah. When I ref football for intramurals last year here at Widener University, we were taught that.
Now some communication with the bench. It looks like they're going to go audible this play here. As Widener switching up as well, going with their very medium coverage two-safety setup, and they will split, and they will be running outside, and will get run into there. A sea of blue jerseys and a lot of whistles as there's a bit of a tension there between number 88, or excuse me, 38, excuse me.
I believe
Jordan Downs.
Yep.
Which Widener play was that? Was he confronting, I believe?
We couldn't quite tell. There were quite a few players around, but I believe Downs was not happy after he wasn't brought down, but I believe got late shoved at the end. That pass towards Marcus Miller was incomplete.
And coach is next to us, not too happy about that play. It is very interesting to share a booth right next to the coaches, so we get a little bit of how the coaches are feeling every time we're up here. We've had a series of mixed emotions. We've got ups, we've got downs. They've got Jordan down, so I mean,
it makes us feel that we're part of the team in some cases. So.
In some instances.
A third and four to go here.
Whitehead looking with a multi-receiver setup. Man in motion. He will be throwing here as he gets brought down in the backfield. The offensive line breaking down super hard, super tragically. And I believe that's number 90, Jalen Singleton, helping out Casey Kirshner down there.
Casey Kirshner, and I believe number 80, Zach Landy, was also involved on that. Just kidding. That's 90. You already spoke about him. But
Jalen Singleton, yes.
Yes. Great job by Casey Kirshner, then trying to get the crowd involved. He's a wonderful player for this team, and it's going to be a shame to see him not on this roster next season, but enough with the emotion. Is it's going to be a field goal attempt here
and
for Kings. And
looks good is good, as Widener will find themselves only now with a 8-point lead. It will be 14-6.
This time it was Mike Tumminello who was...
All right, so I believe their punting specialist, or interestingly enough, is Constantino.
Yes. So I'm glad that, you know, finally midway through the second quarter, we were able to take care of who kicked what exactly.
And now with 5:55 left here in the second quarter, Widener again finds himself up 8.
Only down 8. It technically is a single score game right now, so Widener wants to put some more points on these boards to get that a little more than a single score game. And we got another kicker here. This is Bryce McHelney, I believe.
And
Bryce will send that down.
We'll pick that up just about the 12-yard line. DeAndre Sapp looking to make his way across the field. He breaks a couple of tackles, but will be found and tackled by C.J. Curry of the Monarchs.
C.J. Curry was the one who got his hands on the dancing DeAndre Sapp there. So Sean McGackie wants to get his offense together right before he comes out.
McGackie with a quick throw to Pat Downey, who will make the catch here. 5-yard gain, finding himself at about the 31.
Luckily, no fumble there for Mr. Downey, as it's going to be probably about 2nd and 7. 6. That was close.
Hey, it's 1-yard margin. Can't be mad at that. And now Widener attempting to deliberate here on the sideline. Got about 15 seconds here on the play clock. As it will tick down to about 10 as McGackie will hike this ball. Drops back. He looks deep. He fires over the middle to Gillespie, who finds himself with a catch, and he gets completely drilled by the Monarch safety. What a throw. What a catch.
Yeah, we up here thought Eli Vasquez might have gotten a hand to that one, but another great catch by Gillespie. He's been a great downfield threat for the Pride today, and he helps make this a first and 10 at King's own 36-yard line.
And how about that placement by McGackie? Perfectly in the breadbasket as he will find himself dropping back yet again. He views the field, the left side looking pretty good, but he's going to run. He's going to throw it all the way downfield to DeAndre Hopkins, and it will just fall out of bounds. Or excuse me, not DeAndre Hopkins. DeAndre Sapp.
I was going to say, whoa, I didn't know I'd be treated to a little DeAndre Hopkins action there, but number 20, Michael Butler, got in the way.
You know, sometimes when, I mean, while we do have a bit of a break in the action, I mean, the NFL has been incredibly exciting this year. A lot of interesting games, a lot of teams who underperforming as compared to how we thought they would this year.
Yeah, that's right. And, of course, the hometown Philadelphia Eagles have been sensational this season behind second-year quarterback Carson Wentz.
Who is just a treat to watch, to be honest.
A treat, a class act on and off the field for the Eagles. Philadelphia very, very lucky to have him at the helm.
And now, as a city, we can laugh at Cleveland for continually messing up their quarterbacks forever until the end of time. And I don't know, maybe they can find a quarterback here that they desperately need.
Well, you know, unfortunately this past week with an exciting NFL trade deadline, they tried to get a quarterback, and the Browns just didn't put the trade proposal in time. So that's another indication of how wonderful the Cleveland Browns are, as McGackie will just quickly throw that ball out of bounds.
I actually read a report that said that was somewhat false. I believe it was something along the lines of the Browns ready to make the trade, and I think the Bengals just never, like, completely finalized it, and then it just kind of went by the wayside. But, man, if you're Cleveland, you're not existing for very much longer, I think.
If you're Cleveland, once a week something goes catastrophically wrong.
How they continue to, like, operate under this.
I don't understand it either.
And now they're gonna push forward with what's left of their team, and now we come back to this game as McGackie will be airing this one out to Gillespie, who almost with a sensational catch.
Wow. Gillespie tried for touchdown number 2 on the afternoon, but that ball just hit the ground. So a wonderful attempt there. We've seen quite a few wonderful, amazing catch attempts, but unfortunately Gillespie was not able to bring that ball down.
I think that may have been the sweetest attempt thus far. That would have been sensational.
Yeah.
Almost perfect placement. Gillespie almost had enough space to get under it, but unfortunately, no. As we will face a 3rd and 10 here for these Widener Pride, and we will see how McGackie does. He scrambles. He's going to throw it over the middle to one of his receivers, who's going to get dropped about halfway, too. And it will be about a 4th and 5, maybe 4th and 6 situation.
I don't know how smart of a throw that was, because there was 2 players right there. But you know what? I'm not the quarterback. I'm not controlling the offense. They still got some yardage out of it, but it is going to be a 4th and 5. So Michael Razick will come out to attempt another field goal here.
But how about the confidence from McGackie to be able to make that throw?
Listen, when you're threading the needle to Gillespie earlier in that drive, obviously you're going to try and throw it there. And fortunately, they just couldn't get quite enough yards on that play. So there's the kick from Razick.
Oh,
that
will
ball
get
was
touched.
Tipped.
And from the left hash mark, that one is no good. A piece of the ball getting touched by one of the Monarch players.
I want to say that was number 12, Jake Minetti, who was on that.
Also, this time I'd like to remind those involved in the presentation for softball and the Honorable for Autism to please move toward the field for our halftime presentation. Thank you.
So, 1st and 10 now for the King's College Monarchs. Zach Whitehead right back out there. He's going to hand this ball off. That was Titus Nelson, who's going to pick up about 5 yards or so. Second and five, so it's going to be second and five on their own 25.
Now about 2.5 minutes. There is interception by number 27. That's Anthony Jordan, who will take this to the house. Pick six for Widener, and they will take a 20-6 lead.
What is Zach Whitehead thinking on that throw? What is he thinking? Yeah, we get it. Corey Flynn, I mean, he had a man on him as well, but you're trying to throw a ball where Anthony Jordan is standing right there. Right there. Not the smartest throw there from Mr. Whitehead, and it's gonna pay now, as it's 20-6 as Michael Razick will come out yet again.
And Whitehead, a seemingly appropriate name as he gets popped there, as Widener with a very pivotal pick six here within the latter minutes of this second quarter, and 21-6. 2.5 minutes remaining here from the Leslie C. Quick Stadium on Hirschman Field. What an impressive outing so far. See, they've started to pick it up. The first quarter was a bit of a drag. One score, but it's all right. You gotta start somewhere, and now we have two touchdowns this quarter, and it's starting to get better.
That's right, Nick. We've seen a lot more points on the board here as ROTC drop and give me 21 now. And I'm glad that they're able to do that and not me, so.
4, 5, 6.
That's right.
And they're going.
But if you're Zach Whitehead and Kings, you gotta come on this drive right now and do something positive, because that pick six right before the end of the first half is really, really going to kill your confidence and your play. So something positive's got to happen here for Kings.
All right, by the way, I just counted how many times they went up and down. I swear it was more than 21. Do they maybe do it for total points? That would be kind of nuts. Could you imagine a 50-point contest from each side?
I was going to
say, drop and give me 100 right now.
I was going to say, God forbid if there's a shootout, what happens with them? But
oh, man. I'd rather just donate to charity. And
yeah.
Widener is seeming to go after the ball carrier here on this kick return, and he will get caught at about 15-yard line. And, Whitehead again on coming back out onto the field for this offensive drive, and I think you said it best, and they really need to utilize this drive here as a turning point, because Widener will be getting the ball back after the start of the next half. And I think this is about a pivotal time as ever for you to turn it around for your team.
That's right. They need something positive. They just need something positive to talk about in the locker room during halftime. And if the last scoring play in this first half was that pick six, God help this offense for Kings. So
you can't imagine their coach would be incredibly happy about this performance so far. As he will get
that
stuffed and run back.
Titus Nelson, obviously, no for progress there, as Widener just pushed him back. Second and eight, ball on their own 19. Zach Whitehead and Titus Nelson. Once again in the backfield, Whitehead.
Ooh.
Oh, just gets taken down there.
Joe Fox.
Third and 10. I believe Widener called a timeout on the play. Oh, head coach Mike Kelly, you gotta believe he's happy what he's seeing so far here in this first half. And a thing that Danielle Cardona actually touched on earlier this game, this is his fourth season as head coach for the Pride. So, essentially, he was brand new to this school when we were brand new. And
yes,
when all his freshmen for the football team were brand new. So, this is his first class that he's sort of kind of gone through completely. This was his first recruiting class, and you know, by the time this season does end, I'm sure he is going to miss this great group of guys.
I mean, just think about all the seniors leaving. wherever that list may be. We have Montrell Hicks Taylor, James Gillespie, so there's a good portion of the receiving core. Kirshner gone. Lowry gone. Nobles gone. Vieric gone. Joe Fox gone. You have a lot of key starters for this team gone after this year. Oh, my goodness. He throws it up, and it's going to be picked by 31 Savage Kyle Lowry, and that'll be the fourth interception today. Man, King's coach has got to be furious right now.
I just said earlier, what is Zach Whitehead thinking? Well, I'm going to say it again. What is he thinking throwing in double coverage like that?
I think he's just trying to force something the best he can, and I mean, obviously, he's not going to get anything out of it because Widener coverage has been way too strong.
It's just, as somebody who watches football, it's just disappointing watching these mistakes happen, watching this double coverage. And that, especially with the talent of Ryan Lowry, who can easily pick that ball off. So Sean McGackie now will be back out there, and he's going to go to number 83. That was Pat Downey. But unfortunately, Downey could not come up with that ball.
It sounds like the ESPN commentators to our right are having some conversations about the seniors, but they're pivotal. It's a pivotal number of players, and it does hurt them to lose, and they've been balling out.
That's right. Rob Ennis Jr. behind McGackie here. Ooh. That ball is going to go to Rob Ennis Jr. Again, very quick handoffs.
It was a bit of a trick play there a little bit. He fakes the – it's like the opposite of a play action.
Yeah.
It's like a bit of a draw.
You can hear quite a few roars coming from the Kings bench. Widener going to take their second timeout of the half.
And while we have a bit of timeout, just kind of grazing over the Widener Pride roster, we have a lot of incoming young talent from the Delaware County area, even a couple people from my alma mater, Springfield. At least like two or three people, a Drexel Hill individual.
Yeah, you know, at some point, since the season is winding down, you do want to look at some of the younger players because, you know, last year we saw Alex Kriv, the senior quarterback, towards the end of the season, you know, Widener wanted to see what else they had. They wanted to see what players can do in the future, like Sean McGackie. And now McGackie has been the undisputed number one starter for them this year. He's done a great job really directing this Widener offense. So, you know, it's never too early to start seeing some of the younger players, what they can do, what they can prove, especially when they have a game where the score is very heavy in their favor. So
yeah. Now, listed on the numerical roster here in this lovely game day program given to us by our own
Chad Cooper and the rest of the Widener Sports Information crew.
As we see a bit of pocket collapsing here, and they're going to call it a fumble.
Antonio Rogers got the sack on McGackie. I believe he dropped the ball.
And?
Well, it's going to be fourth down.
So Kings are going to call a timeout to stop the clock. Now they have another opportunity. We're a few picks deep here from Whitehead. Is he going to throw it again? I feel like he might. But going back to this whole player roster thing, there is an interesting player I'd like to see at some point. Now, he's listed under this numerical roster under number 30, but on the specific roster sheet we were given, it is not Felix Sanchez. It is a young man by the name of David Strawley. Now, he comes from Springfield, and if I'm not mistaken, he is the blood brother of Chris Strawley, who was in my graduating class. And unfortunately, I do not believe I will have the opportunity to see David play, but maybe he might morph into one of the team's very very strong linebackers going forward.
Yeah, you know, you never know. You never know what these freshmen are capable of this early in their progression because, you know, there's new faces that rotate in all the time, and there's new faces that do well. You know, last year when we were announcing, we never expected to talk about Rob Ennis Jr. like we have. So,
and he's been a pleasant surprise.
Yeah. Oh, geez. Razzik gets taken down.
Yeah, and he will get, they will get flagged for that. That was an ugly hit.
You can see there's a huge rush going into him, and then he got taken out right as he kicked the ball.
Absolutely drilled. There will be a roughing the kicker here. A little little compensation for the Razzik hit.
Running into the kicker, receiving team. That penalty is declined. First down.
Excuse the terminology, but is there really a difference between roughing the kicker and running into the kicker? Is that just like a verbal thing?
I don't think there's much of a difference there.
I think it's about the same thing. It was one of the things that confused me as they continually change the game of football. Again, if you are watching at home, you are watching on Stretch, feel free to share the stream with your friends and family. We do have another full half of broadcast to give to you guys, as well if you're on Facebook. Share with your friends, family, group chats. Make sure you tune into this lovely Widener Pride Day on this gorgeously cold afternoon here at Hirschman Field, as we will get flags a flying.
Quite frankly, Nick, I feel like it has heated up a little bit.
We have
been in the shade
the
this whole time, so
we have gotten the sun a little bit, a little warmth. Not incredible, but you know.
Luckily, one of the only things that is warm is my water bottle. So
that's unfortunate.
Always a pleasure for me, but 54 seconds to go here. Zach Whitehead, let's see what he'll be capable of after the past two drives for him.
And the Pride show blitz, and they will do so as he will throw over the middle to a very wide open
Trey Campbell. Trey Campbell yet again. Stick to the short passes. You don't need to go long. Maybe with the 40 seconds left, but I mean, stick to your bread and butter.
And we see another short pass,
Lord.
This time batted down by number 52. That'll be Darren DeLauro on the SWAT. Smart play, somewhat. I mean, granted, not the ideal situation to be swatting balls. If you probably just tried to put a play on that, tried to pick that up, maybe you could hold on to that, try to run out the clock the rest of the half. But nonetheless, good play here on second and 10 is a bit of a stoppage here by the refs.
Jalen Singleton was one of the players that caused heavy pressure there on Whitehead, and now the refs discussing something.
Play clock is down. It will be kept on the field until the remainder of the half.
Okay, so we are having some technical difficulties with the clock.
As well as the scoreboard.
So the officials will be keeping score, or will be keeping tabs of the clock, so they can let us know when halftime is.
And that's a good thing. As play will continue now. Showing blitz yet again, stacking the box a little heavy. It'll be a rush from the outside, complete blindside. It will be put up in the air, and it'll be caught by number 10, Joe Fox, with the interception. Oh, and he fumbled it, but it's going to be knocked out of bounds, so it should be Widener possession anyway. Is that four or five?
I believe that's five, but I believe that is three in a row.
Yikes.
Three in a row. We haven't seen this many picks in a row since.
The anti-Michael Jordan.
Yeah.
The five crucial picks here from what could have been a more dynamic game here from Zach Whitehead. And outright shocking he has played this way so far.
In all fairness, I don't believe that pick might have been his fault. But the other two certainly will.
You don't
want to
bobble the ball into the air.
Yeah. All right, I believe the play clock is now good.
I don't know what that means anymore.
The head official said it is.
That's good.
I think it was always right, but who knows. It's McGackie now scrambling.
Will be throwing it a short pass to Pat Downey again. very reliable dip and dunk receiver. Seems to be getting a lot of the short slants over across the middle and the sides.
If you're King's defense, you haven't done that bad today. You have not done that bad in the first half.
I mean, yeah, you've given up some long bombs for touchdowns, but you did give up a pick, five turnovers from
your starting quarterback. In all fairness, they've been out there a lot more than they should.
And honestly, that's not entirely their fault. I'd more so put this one on the offense if you're the King's College Monarchs.
Yeah.
As five picks does nobody any good, and you're only halfway done the game. A little bit of deliberation. We have 8.3 seconds left here in the second half before we take a very momentous break. A very short break, excuse me. As McGackey will be passing to the outside, a perfect pass right into the hands of DeAndre Sapp.
Sapp, unfortunately, has nowhere to go, and that is the end of the first half. After one half, your Widener Pride 21, King's College Monarchs 6.
And with that, we will be back again very shortly for the start of the second half. We hope you have enjoyed this broadcast so far, brought to you by the Widener University Television Club. Here at Woo TV, we do a lot of things, including these sports broadcasts. You can also check out Widener News as well as Pride Time. And be sure to check out Widecasts. Oh, they will be adding a second to the game clock. Don't just go anywhere yet. We will have a second to play, and I can't imagine they're going to be doing much with this ball here. Fourth down and five. Oh. They're going to be looking for a long field goal here as it looks to be at about, oh, man, this will be like almost 50-yarder.
Widener just trying to tack on a few more points.
This would be crazy, but, I mean, they have the ability to do it. Okay.
I don't understand what's going on, to be honest with you here, but.
A lot of confusion going on. Fans are confused. I'm confused. My stomach's confused because I'm a little hungry. And players are just walking off the field.
Mike Kelly is on the field.
Oh. So that'll do it. Widener with no timeouts left to burn. Kings called one for some reason. I guess they just need a little bit more time to sort of gather themselves, maybe come up with something a little confusing, a little trickery going
we thought that was the end of the half. I guess not. We got one more play to go here.
Don't worry. If he misses, you totally stuck around, and it was worth it, I guess. We'll see how well this goes. Just before we go to break here. Here at Hirschman Field, it has been quite an outing. 21-6 so far. And we will see if they will extend this lead to 24-6 on this kick. And it will be a lengthy one. We'll see how it goes from the right hash.
He's going to need a big boot here.
Oh. Did they ice him?
That was Ryan Gallagher taking that.
Oh, false start. Let's back that up. Let's go for a deep one. Jake Elliott, eat your heart out. This is D3 kicking here, boys.
I believe the kicking team coming off.
So, never mind.
So, if you're Mike Kelly, are you kneeling this ball, or are you going to throw a Hail Mary?
Well, it looks like they're going to stack the deepest part of the secondary here.
Just in case.
Looks to be a cover three, potentially. I don't really understand this setup at the moment. Nope, and they're just going to victory position, and we'll see you guys at the start of the third quarter.
Thank you. welcome to Widener News, bringing you the latest news from Widener. I'm your host, Amanda Lojeski.
And I'm your co-host, Danielle Cardona. Let's get started.
Do you like to play poker? Well, on Friday, November 3rd, the Pride Rec Center will be hosting a poker tournament in Latham Hall. It will begin at 6 p.m., so make sure your poker face is ready.
And starting next Monday, it's International Week. International Week is where we celebrate and recognize other cultures from all around the world. On Monday, the French Club will be showing a French film in the UC Room G at 4 p.m.
Are you interested in becoming an RA? If you are, you are in luck. RA applications will be open starting Monday, November 6th. If you have any questions, please contact Residence Life.
And spring housing applications will be open on Monday, November 6th as well.
Calling all SGA reps, SGA will be having their general meeting on Tuesday, November 7th. It will start at 7 p.m. in the UC web room, so make sure you are there.
And Widener's Pride Activities Council will be hosting a film on the inside of North Korea at 7 p.m. on Wednesday, November 8th in Freedom Hall, room 122.
Have you never had an interview or are you looking to blow away your future employer? On Wednesday, Career Services will be hosting an interview workshop at 12 p.m. in the Career Center Lounge.
It sure is a good way of preparing yourself for what may come your way in an interview.
Speaking of preparing for our preparing ourselves, let's see how our Pride prepared themselves this week. Mitch?
Thanks, Amanda. Thanks, Amanda. I'm Mitchell McAsey, here to bring you Widener and Philadelphia sports. Widener football took home the win this Saturday against Stevenson, 20-14. Rob Ennis Jr. ran for 117 yards and a touchdown. The win brings the Pride's win streak to four games. Widener heads back home this Saturday to face King's College. And a congratulations to Widener football for reaching 700 wins. They're only the fourth NCAA Division III team to reach this feat. Widener joins Mount Union, Wittenberg, and Washington Jefferson as the only D3 schools with 700 or more victories. And a congratulations to women's soccer for reaching the playoffs. They defeated Lebanon Valley 2-0 this week and ended the regular season with a 12-5 record. They'll head to Glenside, Pennsylvania this Thursday to face Arcadia in the MAC Commonwealth semifinals. Good luck to them. Women's swimming defeated Albright 204-54. Widener swept all 14 events. Christine Kunstler, Jill Budzianowski, and Lauren Griffith all won two individual events during the dominant outing. They'll head back home to face Messiah in hopes of staying undefeated to start the season. Men's swimming lost their match against Albright, losing by a score of 106-64-98. Winning the 4-2 and 100-yard freestyles wasn't enough to claim the victory. Widener will head back home to face Messiah and attempt to bounce back from this week's loss. Women's field hockey ended their regular season with a victory. They defeated Arcadia 3-2 in an overtime thriller. Widener won on an overtime goal by Eliza Newland to send them to the MAC playoffs. Widener will face Alvernia in the MAC Commonwealth semifinals. Women's club rugby conquered the Battle of Gettysburg this past weekend, becoming your 2017 Eastern Pennsylvania Rugby Union champions. Congrats, ladies. They are able to maintain an undefeated season and will be heading to York College on November 11th and 12th for regionals. We wish you ladies the best of luck. In Philadelphia sports, the Eagles made a move to bolster their offense, trading for Dolphins running back Jay Ajayi. Philadelphia sent a fourth round pick to Miami in exchange for the running back. The back will join the likes of LeGarrette Blount and Corey Clement, and the addition will look to further propel the Eagles through the NFC East. The Philadelphia Phillies have brought in a new manager, hiring former Major League outfielder Gabe Kapler. Kapler will become the 54th manager in Phillies history, and is the second youngest manager in the MLB at 42 years old. Philly fans are hopeful that the new hire will jumpstart them back into playoff and championship contention. The Houston Astros are World Series champions for the first time in their franchise's history. They won Game 7 against the Los Angeles Dodgers 5-1. Congratulations to the Astros and the city of Houston. That's all I have for you this week from Widener University. I'm Mitchell McAsey. Now back to the news updates with Amanda and Danielle. Ladies?
Thanks, Mitch. What a great week it was for our Pride.
I would have to agree. Hearing about all of those victories is fantastic, and congrats to the teams and all of their wins.
Speaker Christopher Mele, who is a part of the Department of Sociology at the University of Buffalo, will be coming to campus on November 16th at 4 p.m. in Latham Hall to give a talk about urban development and pragmatic racialization. So if you're interested, make sure you mark your calendar and head on over.
Last Thursday, I had the opportunity to attend the first annual Strut Your Mutt costume contest. In case you missed it, I have the details. There were lots of tricks and even more treats this past Friday on Memorial Field when 35 dogs and their owners participated in the Strut Your Mutt Halloween Costume Contest. This event was organized by students with a goal of raising $250 for the Providence Animal Shelter.
So Professor Angie Corbo, we're in her event planning class, and she tasked us with creating an event that's never been done before at Widener. So we're sitting there thinking, how can we get people to participate? And the first thing that came to our mind was dogs.
Students, staff, and faculty had the chance to enter their dog into the contest in exchange for a $5 donation to the animal shelter. 35 dogs have been entered into the Strut Your Mutt Halloween Costume Contest with 5 different prize categories. Students from all over campus came to support this event because, let's face it, who doesn't like seeing dogs in funny Halloween costumes? In addition to the top 3 costumes, awards were also given to the funniest, cutest, scariest, and most creative costume. The Strut Your Mutt event exceeded the $250 goal. Students have high hopes that this contest will become an annual event at Widener. Reporting on Memorial Field, Danielle Cardona, Widener News.
How cute was that? Last night, students headed over to Latham Hall for Pride Activities Council's monthly bingo event. But this time, PAC took this opportunity to raise money for the Disaster Relief Fund. Students donated at least $2 to receive an extra bingo card. You could win gift cards and even bigger prizes such as virtual reality headsets. By the end of the night, PAC was able to raise $100.
And this Saturday, the Brothers of Alpha Tau Omega and Theta Chi will be volunteering at the Step Out Walk to Stop Diabetes in Philadelphia this Saturday. They will be attending in honor of their late fraternity president, John Sikowski, who passed away on December 8th last semester due to diabetes. Other students from campus are invited to attend as well. John was a student leader and very well known on this campus, as I had the opportunity to call him a great friend. The 5K run starts at 8:30 a.m. and the walk begins at 9:30. Registration opens at 7:30 in the morning. Hope to see you there.
Definitely an event I would like to attend. With all these events taking place, let's see what the weather would be like. Francesca?
Yes, Danielle. Hello, everyone. I'm Francesca Marino. Let's take a look at this week's Widener weather. Fall weather has finally kicked in. Time to bring out your sweaters, your boots, your scarves, and start welcoming the cooler temperatures. Today, you can expect a temperature of 73 degrees with a low of 57. Friday, you can expect partly sunny day with a high of 72 and a low of 46. Saturday, a high of 60 and a low of 52. And for Sunday night football, there would be a high of 69 and a low of 59. Next week, you can expect a bunch of rain, so get those rain boots ready. Monday is a high of 72 and a low of 48. Tuesday, a high of 55 and a low of 43. Wednesday, a high of 54 and a low of 41. And on Thursday, with a high of 52 and a low of 40. That's all I have for you on this week's weather. From Widener University, I'm Francesca Marino. Now back to Amanda and Danielle for the news update.
Thanks, Francesca. Well, Danielle, the warm weather is gone, and I'm very upset about it.
No, the weather in these 60s, I'm not a fan. We got teased with the 70-degree weather. I got to break out my flip-flops. I'm not ready to pack them away.
I know. I agree. In other news, on Tuesday, a 29-year-old man rented a truck from Home Depot in New York and drove down a riverfront bike path right near the World Trade Center. He killed 8 people and injured dozens. The truck driver showed no remorse for his attack. He had apparently been planning this attack for weeks. It appears that the 29-year-old followed almost exactly to a T the instructions made by ISIS on social media for their followers to carry out an attack.
And talk show host Wendy Williams fainted on live TV on Tuesday. Williams was wearing a Statue of Liberty Halloween costume. Towards the end of the show, she began trembling her words and then collapsed to the floor. She appears to be okay, and she did respond to the incident by stating this quote, that was not a stunt. I overheated in my costume and I passed out. But you know what? I'm a champ and I'm back. and we're very glad that she is okay.
In news related to the New York rampage, an NYPD officer is named Hero Cop. Ryan Nash, a five-year veteran, sprung into action and shot the 29-year-old in the abdomen, which put a stop to his deadly route of terror. Nash was with another cop at a nearby high school for an unrelated call when he was called to the scene of the deadly attack. New York Police Commissioner James O'Neill said that the two officers responded to the scene, were confronted, and took proper action.
A lot of sad stories, but on the positive side, you may remember Nurse Wubbles from Utah. She was arrested last summer for refusing an officer to take the blood samples of an unconscious patient involved in an accident. Well, she filed a lawsuit, which is now settling in her favor. She is to receive, get this, $500,000. So what is she going to do with the money? She plans to use the settlement to help others retrieve footage from police body cams, as well as help lead a campaign to stop physical and verbal abuse of nurses on the job.
Well, that was a terrible story, but I'm really glad that she is using the money to be proficient in these body cams. That's all we have for you this week. Thanks for tuning in. I'm your host, Amanda Lojeski.
And I'm your co-host, Danielle Cardona. Hope to see you next week.
What's yours? We're not gonna let him have it. This game might come down to the 59th minute and 59th second. Be the men that I know you are. I believe in you. Believe in yourself.
Yeah. Take it out the bank, go put it up. Got my main hole put up. Straight off the lot, go put it up. My last two foreigns put up. Straight out the bank, go put it up. Everybody hood gon' pull up. I got them on those hands and the rocks. The home of the ran with the diners. Every week I change my clouds. Got a fin this store in my house. Got a building garage, my house. Got a watch my wrist, cause a house. My bitch sleep at my house. Make you sleep at a hotel now. And when you talk me, you talking all cap. And your diamonds ain't looking like tap. I was always looking for the pouch. Keep an army in my lap. Out of Beverly Hills, I doubt. But I still had a ride with that scrap.
Yellow diamond like a man in this camp. Puss dirt in Melly, yellow no cap. Rockin' face, Margiela, that cap. Red sitting around.
I was like, well, if we're live, welcome back to the second half of action here at Leslie C. Quick Stadium, playing on the Hirschman Field grounds, as Widener will be receiving this kick. And Kings will be looking to kick off here in just a moment as we are back underway here.
And that ball was returned. It looks like DeAndre Sapp there on the return.
And now Widener finding themselves back on the field for yet another offensive drive. And I think this one may be one of the more pivotal ones. I mean, obviously we've seen some nice touchdowns thus far, but I think this one could be a potential nail in the coffin for the rest of this game here, Matt.
Yeah, that's right, Nick. The Widener defense has done sensational today, and now it's up to the offense to put that final nail in the coffin, as you did say, Nick, as McGaggy will hand this ball off to Rob Ennis Jr., who will get taken down for about a gain of five. This defense, to end the first half, got three interceptions in a row on Zach Whitehead, and now it's time for the offense to put some points on the board.
We see McGaggy with another handoff here as he will get stopped very short, just about at the line of scrimmage. No gain on that play. And just like that, it is a third down and five situation. Not anywhere near ideal for Widener as they are looking to extend this drive just that much further. As McGaggy looking from the backfield. He almost gets a low ball. DeAndre Sapp will fall through his hands and will be a fourth and out here for the Widener Pride.
And that was number 10, Bruce Damon, with the pressure there on Sapp and the hit. We told you Bruce Damon, player to watch out for today for Kings. He is a senior captain. He has 54 sacks, or 54 tackles, should I say. Leads the team in that. 54 sacks would have been quite impressive. But he does have 1.5 sacks on the season, but he's a dangerous linebacker for this team as Razik will punt that down and return for about 10 yards there, and it's going to be first and 10 for the Kings College Monarchs.
And Matt Russo there on the tackle, on the punt. Just looking at the stats from halftime, Matt, very impressive. I mean, aside from the fact that Widener has forced five interceptions, how about the six sacks on Zach Whitehead? The defensive line pressure really building up for this Widener Pride.
Yeah, Whitehead faced a lot of pressure in that first half, and it resulted with all the interceptions he threw. And this defensive line, we told you, is quite the dangerous one, and we know that they'll certainly get to Whitehead again here in the second half.
And he will be handing off there. Maybe about 2 yards away from the line of scrimmage. As the current Widener Pride fans are just enjoying a very comfortable Saturday here in Chester, Pennsylvania, as we will see a handoff yet again from the Monarchs.
Brian Armstrong, the junior safety on the tackle there, number 21. You can recognize him with the white sleeve that he wears. And this ball will go to Titus Nelson. This is a dangerous run here for Titus Nelson. He'll get pushed out in front of his own bench area. But he will pick up the first down on that third and three. So a wonderful run there by Titus Nelson.
And now we see the a fresh set of downs here for the for the Monarchs. He will hike it off and hand it back, and he will get immediately hit. And the Monarch sideline very hype over that that truck by number 8, Titus Nelson. Again, making his presence known here on this offensive drive. Nelson with a number of key touches so far. And we will see that continue. Whitehead from the backfield. Looks deep. Pressure's on, and he gets sacked yet again, the 7th time today. As it is now 3rd and 10. Or I'm sorry, it's not 3rd and 10. It'll be maybe 3rd and almost 15, Matt.
3rd and 15. You're going to see a dangerous position here for Kings. It's 3rd and 15. You know Widener's going to bring the pressure here, and we know Whitehead's liked to air the ball out recently, so this could be another potential interception. 3rd and 15, Titus Nelson in the backfield for Kings. Whitehead drops back, and then we'll get taken down. I believe that was Vince Char. Another sack for him, and back-to-back sacks, in fact, as it's going to be 4th and 15.
And if you saw Char's reaction after dropping Whitehead, he's eaten out here, Matt. And he's doing a very effective job along with that defensive line. 7 total sacks so far on this very, very long 4th and 20. And that point margin, after seeing drives like this, got to be driving the Monarchs crazy, as this will be a duck of a punt. It'll land very short, down to about the 25-yard line, and will be touched by number 41. That will be Malcolm Johnston on the touch, and we will see Widener's offense take over yet again.
Tim Costantino got hit pretty hard on that punt. To the surprise of many, no penalty on that play. And luckily for Widener, no penalty on that play. And you can tell Jeff Anar and the rest of his coaching staff for Kings are a little frustrated on that call, but nonetheless, it's going to be a 1st and 10 ball on their own 25 here, as Sean McGackie will set up with Rob Ennis Jr. behind him. McGackie will drop back, finds pressure. That was from number 91, Aaron Vaskos, and Vaskos will pick up the sack there. And put Widener back a handful of yards now. It's going to be a staggering 2nd and 19 now for your Widener Pride. McGackie and Ennis Jr. once again. This ball is going to go to Rob Ennis Jr. He's going to make one cut. He's going to go towards the sideline now to get tripped up there by number 1, Cody Stevens.
And we hear some lovely cheers from this Widener University cheerleading team. And again, headed by seniors Alex Kurtz and Carly Dulgarian. And Widener finds a 3rd and 19. This will be quite the play they would have to make, as a 20-yard bomb, as it will be a screen, and he just throws it into the dirt, and will be a flag on the play. And now a hat thrown by a ref. Could a player be ejected here? Somebody, I believe, in the Monarch side of the field, the fan area, someone has a megaphone. Thought that was interesting a little bit, and the ref's still deliberating a little bit, and we'll get a call right here.
We have multiple fouls on the play. Holding, offense, number 62. That penalty will be declined. It'll bring up fourth down.
So
after the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, offense, number three. That'll be half the distance to the goal. It'll be fourth down. Number three, first unsportsmanlike of the game.
All right, so I'm glad they're tracking unsportsmanlike conducts now as Rob Ennis gets his first of this game, and it was a holding by Jake Keem on the offensive line, and now we see Widener about to boot a fourth and 20 of their own from the inside their own end zone, man.
Michael Razek has his hands full with this one. He's in his own end zone, and it's going to get this punt off. It's a good one. Marcus Miller is there. Miller going to continue towards the Widener sideline. There's a big hit right in front of the sideline there by number 92, Brendan Gilmartin.
Just like that, magically we have gone from one mic to two again.
And, feels good to be back, I guess.
Yeah, you know, when you have the mic in your hands, you take it for granted. And obviously, luckily, we each have our own mics now.
Woo!
So that's why we were not speaking at the same time like we were in the first half.
A little awkward, but you know, you got to do what you got to do. It's what you're used to. As the Monarchs will be taking over, Zach Whitehead again handing off and almost grabbed in the backfield, but he will be breaking for a run and he will make a bout to the first down.
That was Jordan Downs yet again.
Jordan Powell on the tackle. Gain of 10 on the first down.
Jordan Powell credited with the tackle. He was sensational in that first half, getting two interceptions.
Now Whitehead again dropping back. Gets pressure and he will be brought down. And look at who it is. Vince Char. All aboard the hype train as he is on fire right now.
Vince Char. Some could argue he could possibly be the defensive player of the game today with as many sacks as he's gotten. And you got to love the fun little celebrations that he has done every sack.
I mean, you gotta think there's a few different candidates you could vouch for in this if you were to pick a defensive player in the game. But we're not there just yet. We still have another quarter to play as Whitehead will drop back. He fires one over the middle and it will be caught by number 7,
C.J. Curry.
Yeah, the linebacker.
Listed as a linebacker, so I guess he's a very versatile player.
And brought down by number 28, that'll be Sammy Ballard, excuse me. I almost called him Sally Bammard. That would have been tragic. And third and 8 situation. A score here would put the Monarchs back into this game a little bit. Breathe some life into this 5 interception offense, and we'll see what happens here.
Yeah. Whitehead will snap it. Quick throw. That's Trey Campbell, who's going to lose the ball. Picked up by Jordan Powell. Jordan Powell taking it all the way.
Man.
The 30, the 20, the 10, and the touchdown, Jordan Powell.
Wow.
Will pick up that fumble and take it down for 6. Wonderful job there by Jordan Powell to pick up that fumble after Trey Campbell lost it. And just like that, the Pride have increased their lead even more.
You know, I really have to give props to this defense. This defense has been insanely good this game. And it's been impressive to see both the defensive line putting pressure on the quarterback to force bad throws. And then you have the defensive backs making hits in the back or hits in the middle of the play, being able to get to the ball. And Jordan Powell finds yet another turnover, picks it up and runs it in for a touchdown. Incredibly impressive here today by this Widener Pride. And they will look to add this up. But oh, it's picked up and he's going to be running for the extra points, but it will be dropped at the 1 yard line. It was incredibly close. The field goal blocked, I believe.
Lots of confusing plays this game, Nick, but that is Jordan Powell's 3rd overall takeaway of this game. We saw the 2 interceptions in the first half, and now he's going to pick up a fumble, take it all the way, and it's going. And that he took that back for points, so that's his 4th defensive touchdown of the season, and it is 27-6. Magnificent, stellar play by the defense today of the Widener Pride.
And now Widener up three scores with 7 minutes here to go left in this third quarter. And quite an impressive showing again, man. It has been quite an entertaining showing from our Widener Pride. We couldn't have asked for a better game.
If you're a Widener fan, you couldn't have. Well, Kings fan,
I'm biased.
Probably.
I'll admit it. At least I can admit it.
That's
Joe
right.
Buck. At me on Twitter.
Yeah. As Ryan Gallagher will set to take this kick.
Just kidding, at Joe Buck. Don't at me on Twitter, actually. Gallagher with the left foot boot. Reminiscent of David Akers. What a lovely kick. Skies it and almost caught by two different people. Oh, ooh. And a key block by the Monarchs, but it will be brought down, and there will be a flag in the backfield. You know what my favorite convenience store is, Matt?
What would that be, Nick?
Be Wawa, but a close second is 7-Eleven, and that's how much time we have left here in this third quarter. As there will be an illegal block in the back call on the Kings. And
it was C.J. Curry again, I believe, getting called for the illegal block in the back.
Some a little bit of disciplinary issues here by these Monarchs.
Well, we've seen that earlier, too, with Kings. They had a delay a game when they had really good field position after a turnover. They had a delay a game that took them back 5 yards, and they just couldn't recover from that. So who knows how they're going to be on this one.
Now, the Lycoming game we got to experience about a month ago, also Lycoming riddled with penalties that whole game, and now we see a little bit of struggle for the Monarchs with the disciplinary issues. And we'll see how that goes going forward as Whitehead anticipating the snap. He will pitch it backwards to an open man in the backfield, and he will gain a couple of yards, but not go too far, as they'll find themselves in about a second and eight or second and seven situation. Second and six.
Yeah, we've seen that play several times, just that quick little pitch. That was to Titus Nelson. Nelson, the bigger of the backs, and he's going to get another shot here, but nothing to be happy about there is Vince Char. Yet again, another tackle by him. And just as we said, maybe Vince Char can be a possible defensive player of the game. Jordan Powell picks up a fumble and takes it all the way to the end zone to add to his two interceptions today. So we'll have our hands full when we have to make that announcement at the end of the game.
And we will see Whitehead again make another pass. The receiver was held up a little bit, and you can see his shoulder pad coming out of his jersey, and he will run out of bounds at about the 45, 46-yard line. And it'll be number 17, Corey Flynn, on the reception.
That was a great turn by Flynn. Brian Armstrong, I believe, was all over him on that play.
And for now, we have the Monarchs. Another pass to Flynn, who will barely hold on to it.
And correction, I believe 27 Anthony Jordan was out there on that play for Corey Flynn.
Apparently Flynn not very nonchalant about his shoulder pad just kind of flapping in the breeze. As they will do another pitch play to the left side, and he will get stopped just short of the first down. I think it may be a third and three situation here.
And careful, everyone started to gang up, and right in front of the Kings bench area. You don't want to have any unnecessary roughness calls on that play. As it's third and one.
Oh, and flags will fly.
Number 72, Joseph Damiano will get called. And the offensive tackle, obviously you're going to make a little false start action when you have to deal with this very tough physical defensive line of your Widener Pride. And unfortunately, it will set them back 5 yards. So it's going to be third and six.
And as I continue to cough into my own jacket and enjoy that situation, Whitehead with a man in motion, he will snap the ball. He looks, He's moving. He gets put down to the ground. Again, Vince Char. Impressive breakthrough that offensive line and a little celebration to go with Casey Kirshner. I don't know if you heard that, but can't repeat that all over the broadcast.
Vince Char and Casey Kirshner doing it week in, week out. They have been dominating offensive lines and quarterbacks this whole season, and Vince Char yet again with another huge sack.
And we will see an all-out blitz. Is actually probably the best part of the day is he will fair catch this at about the 20-yard line. Good field position here from Widener. All they got to do is kill the clock. We have about 19 minutes of game time left. 4:14 left in this quarter, and this one almost in the books, folks.
Number 36, I don't believe our camera panned to this, but number 36 at Kings, Brandon Cohen, and number 91, Chris Saunders, your Widener Pride, got into it towards the end of that play. Luckily, you know, you got to be disciplined in a game like this. Luckily, there was no calls there. But just wanted to bring that to everyone's attention.
And hand off to the outside. It is DeAndre Sapp who will pick up a couple of yards. Maybe one, maybe two. Nothing.
We saw Widener last year call that play. Play after play after play. I'm glad
they love that.
They love the jet sweep there, and I'm glad that, you know, they're a little more diversified in play calling now this season. But
you know who's not a fan of the jet sweep?
Who's that?
Me. I'm not a fan of the jet sweep.
The broadcasters last year were a little puzzled seeing that.
A little angry at the play calling, but oh, a little bit of contact over the middle, and we will see a third down and 10.
They're a little more diversified now, and
we did talk about that a little bit at the beginning of the game.
Yeah,
a little bit.
It was always the jet sweeps to Montrell Hicks Taylor and DeAndre Sapp, and honestly, this might have been the second one I think I've seen all game.
I don't know if I've seen one before that, so
yeah.
It could be the rarest of occurrences this game is.
Which, if you said that to me last year, I'd say no way. But
that was like the number one play. Like, if you're playing Madden in your recent plays, that's the only one that shows up.
That's the only
every
one.
Time. And we will see yet another handoff here to the running back, and he will just about pick up the first down here as there is a bit of an altercation. What an impressive run by Rob Ennis.
Cody Stevens took him down and is very verbal with the Widener bench and Mike Kelly.
Oh, man, Mike Kelly is getting into it with him. I kind of like it. I like the feistiness. Just don't talk about the Eagles again, and that might be a smart idea.
Oh,
that was a debacle.
That's a low blow from you, Nick, but you could remember what happened a few years ago with Mr. Kelly. But
I don't forget things like that.
That ball goes to DeAndre Sapp. What a turn. He's going to keep going and finally get taken down by Cody Stevens.
My memory is not fantastic, but I will remember that for as long as I'm here anyway.
I believe the sideline official had to just get in the face of Cody Stevens as he's still talking to this Widener bench area.
I think my point about the brutality of this game and the feistiness, the heatedness normally we see in Del Val Widener games is coming out here against the Monarchs.
I was going to say, what you see for like a Rowan or Del Val, definitely not the case for Kings, but it's starting to heat up here as McGaggy just got taken down, a push and shove after that sack. That was number 91, Aaron Vasquez again.
Oh, my God. Okay, greatest thing right now, whoever number 10 is, I think that's Bruce Damon for the Monarchs, is yelling at our bench, our boy, comm student Justin Hardy. What's he pointing to? The scoreboard. I love it. I absolutely love it. And just to remind you, the score is 27-6, just in case any Monarchs people may forget what's going on.
Or if you're just tuning in, if you're Mike Kelly or any of the other coaches, you want to settle your players down. You don't want any undisciplined penalties coming from them when it's your offense out there trying to work. So it is 2nd and 18.
And
there is a flag.
Fly.
We might have something here. Widener going to have to call timeout.
Again, I'd like to say that this broadcast is sponsored by and brought to you by the Communication Studies Department here at Widener University. If any of our viewers would like to become a broadcast benefactor, please contact Dr. Tim Skopansky in the Communications Department. Our next broadcast will be the season opener of Pride basketball season, whenever that starts. And we will be complete. That is official. Word of the mouth of Dr. Tim Skopansky himself.
Yep, that is right. We are looking forward to seeing what Widener Pride basketball can do this season. We remember last year the emergence of Sam Smith and how great he was. And thanks to Sam, if you are listening, my voice was heard on CBS last year for calling the Geico
play
of the year. Great call, even better play, though,
yes,
as Sam Smith made an amazing buzzer beater to send the game into overtime. But many people excited to see what Widener has to offer with Sam Smith. And, of course, who can forget the human highlight reel himself, Sardaya Sambo.
Oh, man, what a player.
Both of them very excited to get the season started. They will be in action on November, I believe, 17th.
And it will be a great pleasure broadcasting those games because we had a ton of fun doing them last year. And now we see Widener back at again. McGackie will be breaking right, looking for a pass. He sails one downfield, and he will.
Oh, wow. There wasn't a somewhat tackle there from Widener, one of Widener's wide receivers. That would have been an interception. To go back to Widener basketball, however, Widener, Chris Caridio, head coach Chris Caridio, and the rest of the Widener Pride, projected fourth this season, which is wonderful, which means they would make MAC playoffs if season ended, started and ended today. But they were number two last year, unfortunately lost to number three Albright, but we will see what they have in store this season.
Wow, McGackie's airing this one out to Montreal Hicks Taylor, and the Monarchs will not come down with that. It's a good play to at least break it up. They will see a 4th and 18 situation here with about a minute and a half in the third quarter.
I believe that's Justin Foster who broke up that ball. And now Foster will head over to receive this punt.
Oh, as I was getting in the bit of Widener sports advertising, or at least Widener comms advertising here, meant to mention earlier that tune in to Widecast Radio every Wednesday night from 4 to 5, and you can tune in to me as well as co-host Andrew Proctor, who is the technical director for this broadcast, and Dakari Daniels, and we will be talking sports. It is the W Sports Hour, and it's quite an entertaining one. If you're on campus, you can listen to in the cafeteria or inside the gym. And it's quite the show every week, Matt.
Yeah. I love tuning in, love hearing the broadcast. And, I mean, this is also a shout-out to if anyone wants to join Widecast, by all means, certainly do it. For the past, I guess, year and a half, not recently, my freshman year and half of sophomore year, I had the pleasure of doing an MLS radio show. But
it was,
you know,
pretty good
days
too.
Have kind of passed me. I don't like speaking about how bad the Union are week in and week out. But, you know, with this revival of the radio station, I certainly would love to bring the MLS back into light.
And not only that, but we did just get a brand new recording studio inside Freedom Hall yesterday.
Right. Yeah, that's right. Thanks to, I don't want to say me because that sounds selfish, but my group.
What was partly you?
My group in an event planning class with a few other comm students.
Should we name drop them?
Yeah, I'll give them a name drop as that run will reach the 35. Corey Lobenstein, Will Hoon, and Kenton Chambers set up a ribbon cutting ceremony for Nick, Paul Keenan, and of course the always lovable Dwight Deworth Pallmeyer, and we kind of unveiled the brand new sound room, the first floor of Freedom, with a beautiful sound booth in it as well. So if you want to take a look, feel free to come to Freedom whenever you would like.
And soundproof, no less. Very high quality stuff, just the best that you can offer here at Widener University. And goes to show, like, the comms department's coming together for some great stuff here.
Yeah, nice, you know what? Everyone looks out for each other. PR kids helping the radio broadcasting kids with this ribbon cutting ceremony, and
also
we're one big family here in the communications department.
If I could extend a couple more thanks to Angie Corbo for running that class. Number one, great stuff. That was a late hit. That is not going to be very good.
As much
that's,
as we
that's
love,
going to be pushing back.
As much as we love Angie, we might have to stop the shout-outs for a second. That was a brutal late hit. Mike Kelly is on the field furious.
Kiko Alonso-esque almost.
Oh, that looked exactly like a Kiko Alonso, Joe Flacco play. Luckily, Whitehead got up and knows where he is, unlike Mr. Flacco.
Who was on Easy Street out there.
That's
when
right.
He took that hit.
That's right, but Whitehead, we're not quite sure. I believe it was Anthony Jordan who went in on him there, but we will get further confirmation later. But that was a brutal late hit. So, several flags on the field. We're going to see what officials want to talk about here. That what?
That will be Anthony Jordan on the late hit. All right, so with that penalty, there will be no last play as we will get a fresh clock as it now enters the fourth and final quarter of this game, Matt, and it's been an exciting one thus far.
You know, to be honest with you, Nick, this game has gotten a little out of control, and these coaches need to settle the players down. So first off, we saw Cody Stevens talking, getting in the heads of the Widener of the Widener bench area, as well as Mike Kelly. And then all of a sudden, at the end of this play, we see a late hit from Anthony Jordan on Zach Whitehead. Whitehead slid. He was already down, and Anthony Jordan went right into him on a late hit. So, unfortunately, the game is getting a little out of hand. And the officials and the coaches are going to have to settle this game down.
Oh, and you're totally correct. And as we have a bit of a break in the action between quarters here, I would like to extend one further thanks by saying thank you to the president of the university, Dr. Wollman, who graciously appeared and was able to cut the ribbon for the ceremony and the unveiling of the new sound booth at Freedom Hall yesterday. It was a great pleasure having her come in and honor us with that. And it's a momentous occasion. Maybe we'll see some more leaps and bounds here for the comms department as it just seems to keep getting better for us.
Yeah, the comms department and this event planning class put on three other amazing events as well as an adorable Halloween costume contest for dogs, which was certainly an occasion. I brought my friend's dog, Coda, the husky puppy. And he
adorable,
was a,
by the way.
He was a sensation for many. But we've gotten a lot more recognition from the president and the higher ups here at Widener, so we're hoping to continue that excellence as Jordan Downs will get hit there.
And we do get a bit of a statistical update here. Zach Whitehead has attempted 43 passes today. That is the first stat that jumps out at me. He's 22 for 43 with 5 picks. No touchdowns, 216 yards, sacked 10 times.
10 times is a staggering number.
Yes.
Like, a very staggering
like people,
number.
Like, single players end up with 10 sacks in a season if they're great.
Yeah.
And now we have 10 sacks alone from this game. And Vince Char himself with an impressive 4.5. Kirshner with a 3.5 himself as well.
And there's going to be a flag on the play now. As we are trying to get all these tons and tons of papers together.
Hey, man, we never told we were going to save the trees out here.
Yeah.
This
yeah.
is not the this not the not job, the line of...
not the most eco-friendly.
No, not really. Not the line of work we foresaw ourselves going into, environmental protection. But these papers will get recycled eventually. And now we have the Monarchs setting up here, showing blitz for Widener, and they will hand it off, and he will
oh,
get
wow.
crunched.
Hello. Look at that big hit.
That'll be Joe Fox.
Joe Fox.
Looked like, to make a very outdated wrestling reference, looking like Marcus Corvon out there with the pounce.
Oh, my Lord. If I woke up today, Nick, and I woke up and realized that I was going to hear a Marcus Corvon reference
in 2017,
I'd say you're out of your mind. But that's perfect head-on
oh.
reference there. That pass was targeted for Corey Flynn, incomplete. So it's going to be 4th and 13 on Widener's 41-yard line.
And I try to throw some of the more out there references, see what sticks.
Yep, only the true wrestling fans, if you are listening, would be aware of who he was.
Yeah, the 2005 TNA fans and then the revamp ECW fans. All five of them.
Yeah, these guys are not your Roman Reigns, John Cena's anymore.
No, he was the original alpha male.
That's right. The original big dog, as some will say. There's another punt there from Tim Costantino. Reinhardt took that bounce there, luckily into his hands, and will get taken down around the 10-yard line.
What do you think about him picking up the ball there? Because I think I might have an opinion about that.
Deep down, I think there's a lot of players coming at him, and he could have gotten hit really hard.
Yes.
But I think that ball is going to bounce towards that 1-yard line if he did not. So I think overall, smart decision there by Reinhardt.
Aside from the fact that was like rolling towards the end zone,
that's right.
Even smarter for Reinhardt to pick that up because they have to play with this clock. There's 13 minutes left on this game clock, and they have an entire field to go. So if they play all four, like not all four, but if they play all three downs and chew the clock here, then this could be a very easy rest of the game for them, and there will be a flag after the Rob Ennis run. And we'll see what the officials have in store for us. And that ball is coming right back.
It's going to be a holding call now, so let's just ignore that beautiful little run there from Mr. Ennis.
I want to hurt a little bit. I felt like an Eagles 2014, 2015 penalty.
Oh, yes.
Every bit of positive they got is just ruined by a penalty.
Well, as sensational as they are playing this year, it still happens with the refs.
Oh, yeah. Can we talk about Peter Morelli?
Peter Morelli.
He is the guy to hate in Philadelphia if you despise refs. And we will see another attempted running play, and they will.
I think that's at the 1-yard line. I don't think he got in the end zone. I don't think that's a safety. But it's going to cause some big concerns. Jake Minetti, one of the other senior captains on this team, gets credited for that hit. Jake clearly read where Rob Ennis Jr. was going to go. So it is 2nd and 22. Another 2nd and forever here. Ennis Jr. and McGackie in the backfield. McGackie's going to throw this ball.
It's going to go to Montrell Hicks Taylor, and he will take a spin and continue to break inside. He's breaking multiple tackles. He tries to force the fumble from behind, but Montrell Hicks Taylor with a great catch and run, and they will find themselves either just short of the first down, or they may have gotten moved the chains.
What a splendid run there. Unfortunately, I think he's going to hobble off, but Eli Vaskos was taken through the spin cycle on that play. Great job by Montrell Hicks Taylor to turn a little play into a bigger play.
That almost could have been nothing, and he turned it into a 6-yard game because they were much farther back than 10 yards.
Yeah.
And they will find yet another run to Ennis as he cuts inside and just short, it seems, from where the ball landed. And it will be 4th and inches or 4th. Oh, no. Never mind. It is a first down.
Little generous spot there, most
likely. It's a good thing the refs are down there.
From the officials, yep. Once again, thank God we're not on that field either making the calls or throwing penalties, because it would be a disaster out there if we did.
And now Widener just has it's them versus the clock, as they have 11 minutes here to chew between that now and the end of the game, and they will throw it to Pat Downey, who will.
Oh, he got stripped.
But they already called a dead ball before he could drop the ball.
Number 12, Jake Minetti, who's going to pick it up and take it down anyway, just in case.
You never know. But now the whistle blows and play stops. Second and six situation. That's too many S syllables going on there. Too much syllabance. And now it's 2nd and 5 on the scoreboard. 10 and a half ticking off. 7 seconds left on the play clock here. Widener's got to get something off because they're running out of time. And McGackie will hike the ball, and it looks like they're going to be throwing, and he will scramble. And he will get crumbled as the pressure mounts, and they will.
That was Jake Minetti.
There will be a bit of screams from the field. People letting some anger, some frustration out. I'd be angry too if I was down 21.
Third and 12. Sean's had somewhat of a decent sophomore season. He's got two more years ahead of him.
And he's been definitely very impressive for this Widener team, and could see why he has been the next chosen one at quarterback, and he will scramble to his right, and he will just run with the ball. And
that's a late hit.
That's
got
to be a flag, and
that's a late hit. There's pushing and shoving on that bench area now.
Oh, and you best believe people are getting in his face. Refs trying to separate the fight, but there's one Monarch surrounded by the entire Widener Pride bench.
This is not good. What?
Why make that?
Bruce Damon is they're still pushing and shoving. Several players getting into
flags.
It. Number 41, Malcolm Johnson of Kings, also throwing some shoves. Listen, number 10, Bruce Damon, you are a senior captain. You know very well that Sean McGaggy is already basically in the bench area. He's already out of bounds. If you're a senior captain, you need to be better disciplined than to take a shove at this quarterback out of bounds.
And
that was a stupid play by Bruce Damon.
Very boneheaded.
Yes.
Very, very ill-thinking of this man. And we'll see how the refs deliberate, and we'll count the penalties as they come, I guess. And they deliberate, they will.
I
feel like they could break out like a notepad and a pen. And they'd still have some time to write some down. And I couldn't tell if that guy just fell right in front of us.
The thing was, it wasn't even a question if he was right before out of bounds.
As a defensive player, you gotta know he's going out of bounds.
He was over the line. There wasn't a question. He was over the line and just got pushed down by Damon. We told you Damon was going to be a player to watch for. Not for those reasons, because he is a talented player who leads his team in tackles. But when you decide to go out there and take a push on a defenseless quarterback out of bounds, that's uncalled for. That is blasphemous, and it is uncalled for.
It is quite asinine as very poor decision-making. I mean, even if you're trying to come back into this game, what's the point? Like, that does nothing to help you whatsoever. It's not like putting in Widener's backup really does anything to hurt them. I mean,
luckily it wasn't that big of a push, but still, the principle of the matter, he shouldn't be hitting.
You're not supposed to hit a defenseless player like that as he's going out of bounds. You know he's going. You can see him. You're running with him out of bounds. Here we go.
Personal foul, late hit, defense number 10. A 15-yard penalty assessment at the end of the run resulted in an automatic first down. Also, after the play, unsportsmanlike conduct. Defense number 41, unsportsmanlike conduct. Offense number 3. Those penalties will offset. It will still be first down.
All right.
Number 3, second unsportsmanlike of the game. He has disqualified himself.
Oh.
So
Rob Ennis Jr. finds himself disqualified with his second unsportsmanlike. And we get some BS calls from the fans over here. Hopefully I didn't pick it up too loud, but we will see Rob Ennis for the day. And that is quite unfortunate. And three whole penalties there.
I told you, Nick, things were beginning to get out of hand. What did I tell you?
Spicy.
So Cody Stevens ended up taunting the bench for several plays. Then Anthony Jordan comes in and makes a big late hit on Zach Whitehead. And then McGaggy gets hit out of bounds, which was way late. And I did mention, as that scrap was happening, that number 41, Malcolm Johnson, was getting into it with somebody. I didn't know who it was. Unfortunately, I believe that was number 3, Rob Ennis Jr. Now, because Rob Ennis Jr. already got an unsportsmanlike today, that's number 2. See ya, Rob Ennis Jr., but your time is now done. So who's going to be the running back for the Pride? Randall's been hurt. Ennis Jr. just got ejected.
And it looks like DeAndre Sapp takes the handoff there. So maybe we might see DeAndre Sapp just kind of fill in the running back role there.
Yeah. He's known as a wide receiver, but he does carry the ball quite a few times as that wide receiver, so I guess now he's going to have to slip in there as a running back. So a bunch of fireworks here, to say the least, in this fourth quarter.
And quite an explosive one, as we see another short pass. This will go to Montrell Hicks-Taylor, who will force his way out of bounds. Should be good enough for about a first down.
Eli Vasquez made the initial hit, and number 20, Mikhail Butler, made sure that Taylor didn't break any tackles.
And we see here, shotgun position with a running back behind him. He will hike the ball. He will throw it to Montrell Hicks-Taylor, who finds himself more yardage.
Oh,
he'll find about a six-yard running.
Number 10, Bruce Damon, again. Hard hit, throwing
a little violent out there.
Throwing Hicks-Taylor right at the feet of Mike Kelly. This has been quite the interesting fourth quarter between these two teams.
It's probably been the spiciest out of all four of them. We will fumble the ball here, and it's fallen on top of by a Widener offensive lineman, who number 90 on the Monarchs are just kind of drops his head into the back of one of the linemen.
DeAndre Sapp tried to get that ball, and he got hit.
So I think DeAndre Sapp may be the fill-in here at running back. We saw a lot of them jet sweep plays with him over the years, and I believe Pat Downey's kind of taking his spot on the outside.
I believe a lineman for Widener was able to cover that ball.
Yes.
After Sapp got hit. So it's 27-6, 6:53 to go here. McGaggy's going to drop back. There's the throw. That was caught by number 83, Pat Downey.
And I think that makes up for his fumble a little bit earlier. He extends the drive. He kills the clock. He gets the first down.
Yep. Time is going to tick on down here.
Now we push forward. We're less than halfway through. We are at about 6 minutes and 26 seconds and counting. As the clock ticks down, we got 15 on the play clock, as this play will get off well before the play clock even gets close to ending. And McGaki will be throwing on the run, and it was appearing to be either to Downey or Hicks-Taylor. I think that might have been to Downey specifically, late turn. And we will see a second and 10 here. Oh, remember how I said it was a nice cold early afternoon? Now it's heating up.
Yeah.
Sun's beating down right in the broadcast booth. The jacket comes off.
I thought I was going to regret wearing short sleeves today, but
you were wrong.
In the end, surprisingly, I won that one. So
everything's coming up, Nissenfeld.
Yeah. It's a big day.
It's a big day for the boy. Big day for the boy.
So second and 10 now, ball on King's 33-yard line. McGaki going to scramble for a little bit. That ball hits the ground short, incomplete. He was trying to get that ball to Pat Downey. We do have an injured player now.
I believe that's Dan Vierick.
So an injury timeout now. The injured player has come off Oh, he's going back. Or Ryan Stecklin has checked in. Ryan Stecklin has checked in for the injured player. And I believe that was 63, Mark Funk, who was injured. Yeah, that is 63, Mark Funk. We're not going to speculate anything.
Maybe we'll get an update from our field reporter.
We walked off on his own power, which is good. The head trainer still talking to him.
And McGackie will drop back. He looks to throw deep, but he will scramble as the pressure looms. And he finds Montrell Hicks-Taylor, but it will get swatted from behind. Eli Vasquez on the breakup.
Eli Vasquez has had quite the busy second half. We didn't talk about him much in the first half, but he is a very dangerous player for this team. Has 46 tackles and one interception heading into this game. So it's a fourth down.
And now we see a very interesting fourth down coming here. We have 6 minutes in running as the
Razek's going to run with this.
Oh. I mean, I don't know if anybody else heard that at home. Someone yelled stupid call, but we're up 27-6 with 5.5 to play, and it's all essentially in the hands of the Monarchs. So it's a good thing that guy's on the bench, not a coach or a player, because, I mean, he gets it.
That is correct, Nick.
Do you know what I think's worse than that play, that play call? Throwing 5 picks. I think that might be the dumbest move of the game.
Yeah, that is right. Zach Whitehead coming out. Yes, Titus Nelson with him. If you're Widener, you want to be disciplined. How do you be disciplined? You don't late hit Zach Whitehead here, or
yeah, exactly.
Who knows what kind of trouble we'll get in.
Last thing we need here is a brawl, as Whitehead will hand it off, almost play action, and you will drop at about halfway through the line of scrimmage, and it might be a second and 5.
Here. Yeah, looked about 5-yard gain there.
I think I'm tanning, Matt. It's warm.
Yeah.
Jiminy Christmas. If I just go like this, maybe it'll work faster.
Maybe it'll work out in your favor.
As Whitehead will continue to throw. Yet again, it's popped up and out by number 10, Joe Fox.
Trey Campbell has been targeted quite a lot in this game. And, I mean, he is a difference maker. Heading into this game, he has 29 receptions for 362 yards and 4 touchdowns. So he has had a decent year.
Yet another drop in the backfield for the Widener Pride. Vince Char again.
Again?
Is it any surprise at this point?
Not at all.
Long day, Matt?
Yeah, long day. Not at all, Nick. You know, Vince Char has just...
It's almost tiring seeing Vince Char with all these sacks.
It is. It literally is. But wonderful playing from Vince Char. We thought Kirshner would have the bigger game of the two, but it's been Vince Char today. And this defense, nice and easy. What, play about 3 downs and then they get to take a rest on the bench?
Yeah, it's nice to know that fourth down fake punt run was a waste of time, as now Widener forces a 4 and out, and now they have the ball back with less time on the clock.
And here comes the Widener offense. Just to let all of you know who are listening at home, this game, once again, is brought to you by Woo TV, Widener Productions here. If you'd like to join Woo TV, feel free to contact Dr. Tim Skopansky, or honestly, just talk to one of us. Andrew Proctor has done a wonderful job on this broadcast, as well as everyone else who has contributed. So, you know, broadcasting these games, doing our own shows such as Widener TV, doing a fantasy football show, it's It's been great, and it's been great work and great experience. And so if anyone is interested, feel free to contact any of us. We'd be happy to let you in, and we'd be happy to have you help us broadcast bigger and better events. Sean McGaggy will hike this ball. He'll hand this off to DeAndre Sapp. Sapp's going to continue towards the 30. He's going to decide to go the other way now. Who knows what he wants to do with it. Sapp's going to finally get taken down by Jacoby Forsman.
And while this flag situation happens, we will quickly throw it to Danielle Cardona, who had a chance to chat with Widener Pride linebacker Joe Fox. Danielle?
I'm here with linebacker Joe Fox. Now, Joe, great start to the first half of the game. Now, what needs to be done in order to reach that next step to get to playoffs?
We just need to keep playing our game. We've been playing hard all season, and we've been getting better all year. So we just need to keep building on what we've built upon and just keep playing hard.
Now, senior day, last home game of the regular season. What are you going to miss most about being on this team?
Just this atmosphere and my brothers. I mean, 4 years we've been through thick and thin. We've been struggling the past 2 years, and it's just good to see all of our hard work paying off this year.
Next season, will we see you in those bleachers?
I'll definitely be here every day, every Saturday.
Thank you. Good luck on the second half.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
And thank you so much, Danielle. We are back. So with 3 minutes and counting remaining, I'd like to take a moment to thank everybody who has been a part of this broadcast team, starting with Amanda Lajewski, Andrew Proctor, Carly Dunbar, Danielle Cardona, Leon Mopisha, Sam Hollander as well, and... Us here in the booth. Thank you for being here, Matt.
Oh, yeah, no problem. Thanks to everyone who is listening to this game. We love the support. And right before you went on that list, Nick, Muhammad Abdur-Razak.
Our boy, it's Moo!
Moo, that's right. I believe he got a carry right before you began the list, and now he's back in there.
And look at our boy. Our boy, Moo.
Number 24.
This might be my favorite play of the drive.
That's right. Moo, as well as... Matt Arthur have been rotating in and out with carries now. So great job by Mike Kelly to let the seniors get some time on senior day, a day honoring them, of course.
Oh, Moo with the big truck, and he keeps moving. And the bench gets hyped and loud. Gotta love Moo out there fighting for those extra yards.
That's right. You gotta love it. And Matt Arthur checking back in. So I told you before, the two senior running backs checking in back and forth for each other.
So again, just to kind of clarify the list real quick, director Andrew Proctor, replay Carly Dunbar, cameras 1, 2, and 3, Sam Hollander, Leon Mopisha, and Dakari Daniels. Play-by-play by your boy, Nick Safiri, yours truly, and color analyst Matt Nissenfeld, and Ross Field reporters Amanda and Danielle. Thank you for tuning into the stream, and and short on the play. They will turn it over on downs, but there's now only a minute 21 left.
Minute 21.
It's just the clock at this point. Do we have any last minute jokes or things we can get in here while we have time?
You know, I think what makes this broadcast good is our jokes are on the fly.
Yeah.
We're very good with improv and you can't just put me on the spot like that.
That's where the improv just comes in and strikes.
When something comes up, I'm sure we'll make the best of it, just like your Marcus Corvan reference earlier. Man. Who can forget about that? So
that one's probably going to haunt me for a while. It made me feel a little bit bad now that I said it.
That's right.
I don't know. But
Whitehead and Downs out there for most likely one last time.
Maybe this last drive, unless they completely break open a one-play touchdown, but we'll see. As Whitehead will
or
take
a pick six.
We'll see. And he just dives at the line of scrimmage. Wanted to avoid getting hit. I don't blame him.
To correct myself and Nick as well, that is Gabe Bichella in at quarterback now instead of Zach Whitehead. I think Zach Whitehead has had enough of the Widener defense for today.
Maybe the coach had enough of Zach Whitehead. Who knows? But another running play here.
That's Downs.
Ooh.
He's going to pick up the first down there.
Will break for quite a number of yards, and we're just inching closer to the finale of this game so far. All right, with time winding down, Matt, and with the play clock almost mirroring the game clock, who would you say your player of the game is today?
Has to be Vince Char because, yeah, you know what? Jordan Powell made that great fumble recovery and touchdown as well as two interceptions. But I don't think those plays would have happened if it wasn't pressure from Vince Char. Vince Char has had an incredible number of sacks today and big hits. And hats off to you, Vince Char, because I feel like you are the defensive player of the game today.
And quite a player at that. If I had to go on the offensive side of the ball, I would have to say for sure Sean McGackey has been – incredibly solid out there. He's been phenomenal with his accuracy. He hasn't really, he's thrown some bad passes, but they've been knocked down. No interceptions for the most part, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Yeah, that's right. And you know what? He shared the wealth. He shared the wealth. You know, we saw a touchdown from Gillespie, and we've seen some other touchdowns from Montrell Hicks Taylor. He hasn't targeted just one guy completely. And Sean McGackey has done a wonderful job threading the needle, hitting guys in stride. So wonderful job today by Sean McGackey and the rest of this Widener team overall.
And going forward, this just puts yet another good game on Widener's resume as they will head into Delaware Valley for the final game of the regular season. And what a matchup that'll be.
That's going to be a battle as Bichella lost the ball. Sat back on it and before the clock runs out, they're going to stop it. Their timeout was called by Kings, so I guess they believe they're still in this game.
All right, so they're just going to waste everybody's time real quick. And we're not out of here just yet. We still got 20.4 seconds remaining left here on the game clock.
To go here if you're the coaches for both teams. I feel like there's not much left to say because there's only 20.4 seconds left on this beautiful senior day at Hirschman Field at Lizzie C. Quick Junior Stadium. It's one last song here for the Widener Pep
Might
Band.
As well.
And there's Bichella scrambling, throws to Corey Flynn. And that's going to stop the clock. He kept his feet in bounds and then fell out of bounds. First down for Kings. Look at this. They're still trying to make this game somewhat close. They're trying to still tack on some points.
Well, we just got 14 ticks left to burn here before everybody can go home happy. Widener walking out of here with a large W, a very important one, heading to probably into the most important game of the regular season for them, facing Delaware Valley next week and possibly fighting for that MAC championship. And I think if I had to reference any victory, I think this might have been one of the cleaner ones we've seen.
Oh, yeah, certainly. Most certainly one of the...
I mean, the Kings did definitely put up a fight early. They looked like they had found a way through Widener's defense, but all the dipping and dunking could not contain the likes of Vince Char and Casey Kirshner. It's been a very impressive game for this defense as he will air this one out, and it will...
That's a great bounds. Hit, and that is your final.
And as referenced in one of my favorite Jay-Z songs, what's a king to a god, as the
King's College Monarchs fall to the Widener Pride 27-6. And an impressive victory for these Widener Pride. And I think we might as well wrap it up here, Matt.
Yeah, that's it. What a wonderful game it was. Widener 27, the King's College Monarchs 6. I'm Matt Nitzenfeld with the wonderful pleasure of Nick Safiri being by my side. I hope all of you guys back at home enjoyed this, and thank you for watching, and take care.
Enjoy your weekend, buddies.
Do you want to throw it out, or do you just want to hold on to it?